Number 23, right? All right.
And we're live.
Hello, and welcome to the 23rd episode of the Destiny Community Podcast, brought to you by Blue Microphones. This week, Watts is out because she spent all of this week driving Dado and I around Seattle looking for
apartments. Driving Miss Daisy, so to say.
And she was looking for houses. She's tired of shit, and she wanted to take a week off. I'm cool with it.
Nice.
Because, you know, I don't have to edit keyboard clacks out. Sorry.
Don't you worry. I got that covered. Hold on one second. Oh, let me get chatty in chat. Right,
let's get that.
No, no, you don't. And me, no.
It would be like,
Don't worry. My Razor Chroma's got it covered.
On this week. I'm really excited to talk to him, YouTuber and Twitch streamer. Thank you for joining us, Blessious.
Hey, thanks for having me, guys. It's a huge honor, and I'm excited to be on, guys.
Awesome. Blessious, what state do you live in?
Tennessee. Yeah, Tennessee.
Hey!
I know.
Tennessean, at least the next month.
You seem rather
rapidly trying to escape Tennessee, Patrick?
Yes, I am.
Yeah. Like, actively looking, right?
Yeah, like within the next month, I'll most likely be moving. But, you know, for the next month, Bless and I are fellow Tennesseans.
Yeah, neighbors. You're in Nashville. I'm in Memphis.
You're known as Tennesseans?
No, it's Tennessean.
Tennessean,
yeah.
Tennessean. It's a Tennessean. It's the name of the newspaper here, Pope.
The Tennessean?
It's the name of the newspaper here.
Wow.
The Tennessean.
Huh.
We have the Memphian.
Oh.
The Memphian and the Tennessean.
That's really interesting.
That's been super interesting.
It's so interesting.
And in that local news.
Well, see, so you play Destiny. You play a little Destiny.
I play a little Destiny, at least a little here and there every day.
Yeah. So you you stream and... You stream on Twitch, right? Or you do you stream on YouTube?
I stream solely on Twitch, and I'm trying to figure. I usually streamed at nights, but I'm just trying to figure out a better like schedule because I don't know. Like I'm trying to spend more time with my fiance, and
overrated.
I need to be a good fiance. I need to spend a little bit more time with her. So the nights, I think, are going to be more our time. I used to stream like same about time that Tefty used to stream, like maybe like really late, like 8-9 Central Time.
Sounds about right.
She shared with us before the podcast started that she's in the next room playing Horizon. So
yeah,
she should be able to be okay with a little streaming now and then.
Yeah, right.
Now and then. Now that she discovered that. Yeah,
I like that. I like that about it. Is she supportive of your Twitch streaming? Does she stream herself?
No, she doesn't stream. She's in the Navy. So
cool.
A lot of people are like, what does he do? All right, because like you know, they have jobs of importance.
And right. Yes. You know, protecting the country and all that.
Yep. Yep.
Yeah.
You entertain people. You make the world a happier place, damn it. That's important, too.
That is important.
That's what I tell myself every night as I cry myself to sleep. My job's important. It's so important.
We need a Blessius Briar high five right now.
Do it. Almost.
One more time. We're going to have to work on that.
I'll do a countdown for you guys. 3,
all right.
2, 1. Do it.
Boom.
Delay.
Boom. Delay.
How about, okay, one more time. On one, you do it. Okay.
All three. Right. You got it.
2, 1.
That one was somehow worse. All right. For anyone listening, just in the audio version, Blessius and Briar are right next to each other, and they're trying to high five each other through their webcams, and it's
through the inner tubes.
It's not going well.
It's spectacularly bad.
Oh man. Yeah, so you do YouTube and you do Twitch. You're one of those crazy guys that does both mediums.
Yeah.
Is it like daily for you?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
I do one Destiny video every single day, and I try to do like maybe 5 days a week doing like a double upload, like maybe an indie game or a Nintendo game. Nintendo's a little crazy on YouTube, but and then I try to fit in a stream, and it can be hectic.
Of course, yeah.
Do you find that one can interfere with the other? Like some days you want to stream more, some days you want to do a YouTube video more, like, and they get in each other's way, or do you have it like scheduled out? Like, this is like from 9 to 2 is my hours for YouTube, and from 3 to 5 are my hours for Twitch.
Well, what it used to be was 9 to 5, I would be like, okay, I'll try to record 2 videos and edit 2 videos, and then at night I would just stream. And then my fiance is like, why don't we ever spend any time together? Because like when she'd come home, we'd make dinner. I'm like, okay, gotta stream. And it was cool when she was doing classes because she was just like, oh, she has to focus on this. But then when she stopped having college classes, it's hard. It's hard.
Of course.
So,
so now yourself, I'm lucky. Every time my wife sees me, she just says, how come you're not working?
It's the opposite.
You think she would have figured out by now that this is what you do, Briar, but still.
Oh yeah.
You know, I thought I was a little afraid for you, Briar, when your wife showed up on Twitter. Is that caused you any problems? Well. No.
That's not been awesome.
she's threatening to share photos of you over Twitter, and
I love those threats. They're fantastic.
I know. I've been trying to bribe her into.
I know. We need to start bribing her.
I think I'm just going to forget to pay the phone bill for a few months. Cut it off at the source.
I didn't pay the bill. What?
Oops.
And so, Blessius, if I'm listening to this podcast and I'm like, I want to watch a stream today of a new Destiny streamer, and they have never caught your streams. If they jump in, are they going to be, you know, regaled with your amazing PvP prowess, or are they going, what are they going to see?
I am not a pro in PvP and Destiny. I'm B minus, maybe B plus on a different day, but no, I just rather just have fun and just interact with chat and just be more laid back, and then hope to get carried if I ever do trials, maybe do some strikes, but just it's more laid back. Like, I couldn't do carries whatsoever.
Any shout outs to your trials partners?
Oh, Mr. Aries, Red's Mod.
Mr. Aries, Mod Extreme.
Yeah, yeah. Holy Mod. Wow.
Mod Extreme.
He is a Holly Mod, isn't he? He knows everybody. I think we need to have him on the podcast.
I think we do.
I asked him. He said he was too busy, unfortunately. He's like,
have
sorry.
You ever been in a party with him when you're playing Destiny? He's like playing a game and then he's like modding like three or four different chats. And
I know,
like, dude, just focus on the game you're playing. He goes, no, I gotta be.
He's running
chat.
Spark, and then all of a sudden he's timing people out. You're like, what?
I know.
stops running. Just stops running right before the spark cap. And just, no, this guy's being a dick in this chat. Gotta take care of this.
I have to somebody.
So anyway. Something I'm always interested in is how did you get your start? How did where was the beginning? Where was the point where it suddenly turned into becoming a thing that was gaining momentum and all that? You know, like a lot of people like to hear these origin stories. So if you don't mind sharing,
yeah. Sure. I'll try to give you the more condensed version. But I used to live and kind of grew up in central PA where there's nothing around. And I got a start in radio, and I was an afternoon guy, but I was in charge of all the audio commercials, and then eventually did cable commercials. We made cable commercials from radio. Kind of weird. Hmm. But then I took a job in Virginia Beach, Virginia, and all I was doing
was any of them? Can you give us can you give us an ad? Did you do the ad, the audio for it?
Oh yeah, I did a bunch of ads.
Let me hear one. I love those radios.
There's one. I got a free pillow doing this, but there was a place called Sleep World, and these were the honest to God commercials. Be like, wow, it's Christopher walking around Sleep World here. You gotta get these mattresses. And it'd be too much copy in 60 seconds. So it wouldn't be a slow Christopher Walken. It'd be like, wow, it's Christopher Walken. And it would be just yeah, that was my favorite.
That's great.
Yeah. So I moved to Virginia Beach, Virginia for a radio job. And that's when Destiny came out. And I got to be able to play, the alpha, the beta. And I loved it. But I didn't know of the online community. You know, I'd just go to Bungie.net and be like, oh, it comes out this day. And then so the game eventually came out. I remember working at the radio station, and all I was allowed to do was social media work and editing videos. And it was kind of weird not doing commercials or anything. But I eventually got turned on to Twitch, and I was like, man, these people are streaming Destiny. That's awesome. The first person I ever, it's weird, saw streaming Destiny, Philip DeFranco.
Really? Kinda
weird. I know. Weird guy. And it was when people got the game early, I believe. I forget. But it was right around that time. And I saw him shooting Sepix Prime. And I'm like, man, that's awesome. And then I didn't think anything of it. I got Destiny, got level 20. And then I remember them announcing, Vault of Glass coming out. I'm like, man, I don't have six friends that own this game. Like, oh, I'm out of this. So, like, I did stuff like the Loot Cave and everything. But I'm just like, man, I'll never do Vault of Glass. So I kind of put it down until, like, the end of Dark Below. And then right around that time, my fiance was about to be deployed in the Navy. And she's going to be out from, like, the rest of the year. And that's when I proposed to her, right before she deployed. And a month after that, I actually lost my job in radio. And I was kind of bummed. And luckily, I bought, like, this, like, radio microphone. And, like, I had a bunch of audio equipment. I did voiceovers. And I was able to, you know, pay all the bills doing voiceovers. And that's when I discovered the Destiny community. And through my fiance's best friend's boyfriend, we actually, like, started, like, this little clan together. And it was called The Legend of John Cena. Shout out, represent. Nice. That's when we started, like, LFGing people for raids. And it was a long time. And then eventually, like, that's when I was, like, turned on to, like, the entire Destiny community. And, like, that's when I think I started doing YouTube videos August, right before Taken King. And then I just put one out, shared it to Reddit, got a little something. Then made, like, a Goodbye Gjallarhorn video, and it got 500 views off Reddit. I'm like, sweet, man. And then every week I did, like, a couple more. And after my fiance came back, I was kind of hesitant to tell her, like, hey, I'm doing these, because, you know, she just came back from deployment. She's like,
yo, I'm YouTube famous now.
Hey, I got 500 subs, you know? And so she was just like, oh, okay. And then so, like, she was supportive of it. And then I just kept doing one after another, and slowly just kind of built an audience from it.
Nice.
Dense story. Awesome, man.
Nice. Yeah, I remember back when we were also playing Destiny, and, like, we started featuring some of your videos on there. April.
I remember that because my best friend came to visit Memphis. That was a month after I moved to Memphis. She had to be stationed right here, so I followed her, and I had to get a job as a marketing manager at a fast food restaurant. It was not fun. Because radio jobs are, like, nowhere. They don't exist anymore because people
can't
radio.
Like, not a growing industry anymore, huh?
Yeah, like, it's shrinking. So I'm like, I was biting the bullet on it. And I was making videos, and it was right around the time that the April update came. And I did two videos, one for the Taken shotgun and another for, like, some scout rifle. And that's when the PD reached out to me. I was like, hey, can we use your stuff? And I'm like, sure. And my best friend came down, so I couldn't edit it myself, and they edited it for me. And then that's when I saw the aftermath.
Yeah. for those that aren't aware, like, the Planet Destiny thing was we never had someone on the Planet Destiny channel that was mostly based in comedy. It was always very much news and fact oriented. So when you had kind of this unknown guy suddenly start doing these really well produced videos, you know, good sound quality, edited well, and then all of a sudden just come on here and we're like, the entire Planet Destiny audience was like, what the fuck is this? And it was the only other video that was not received as well back on Planet Destiny was Briar Rabbit's Engram opening video, like, at the very start. Because everyone's like, yo, you have opening videos? And then
Was that the video where they sent me a video of you opening Engrams, and I had to do the voiceover for it?
Yeah, because at the time, can you just save up a bunch of Engrams and, like, then just open them? And
What the fuck could go wrong with that?
I don't know. Just everything, literally everything that could go wrong went wrong with that, including the entire community going, No. But it looked like the Call of Duty, was it Advanced Warfare or Infinite Warfare like-dislike ratio? It was bad.
Oh, really?
It was bad.
I thought it was great. I just sat there and made fun of you for 10 minutes.
And I never watched it. I didn't even know they put the video out.
That's awesome.
Oh, man.
All right. So some stuff has gone down this week. Namely, Age of Triumph. They did the reveal stream. What did you guys think of it?
Yeah.
Just yeah.
What did we think of the stream? I think it was awesome.
I just want a black hammer.
Yeah. It's very exciting. For me, it's like it's great because it does two things. One, obviously, we're getting content for Destiny 1 that's well needed. It's great that they're putting the momentum to setting up the stream and all that. But the other big thing for me that I realize that makes me even more excited is that it's finally the end of an era that means Destiny 2 is coming 100%. You know, it's like
they acknowledge it as Destiny 1 right now. I think that's cool.
Yeah, they acknowledge that this is the send off. It's officially happening. Their speech to us is talking about all the dialogue they're telling us is that this is the send off. This is the end. We're gonna usher in the new era after this age of triumphs and all that. And that above all, like getting excitement about new raids and everything is very exciting. But the fact that this is gonna be the end of the chapter to bring in the new stuff makes me very excited. Because I can't wait. I can't wait for the future.
Yeah. I think it should be acknowledged, too, that, Tef, you called this, like, during the April update last year. Like, literally, like, a lot of people on the internet, like, talk about this theory. But the first time I ever heard it was on this podcast. Well, not on this podcast, but on the Play This One podcast. Yeah. When you're just like, what if they brought back all the old raids?
At the light level,
at the end of Destiny.
It made sense because it would be the send-off patch. It would be the patch that you'd come back to if you want to re-experience Destiny 1. And that's basically what they're doing.
Yeah. It was a new idea, though, when you brought it up. And, I mean, it was clearly the right idea. In fact, Bungie went with it. But I think it deserves shouting out.
Thanks. I think it's a pretty easy conclusion in my mind that would eventually happen. But I know a lot of people doubted that raids are going to come back, but... here we are.
Yeah. Yeah. One thing I think is really cool is like if you don't have Destiny, like think about like you can experience the entire game like uninterrupted. Like I don't know, you don't experience it like someone that went through it and you had to wait months for experiences.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's kind of cool. I don't know, someone that like my fiance that doesn't play Destiny, I think she could like, hammer out all the story missions and be like, "Oh, I did something." And not have to, do something, get six missions and be like, that's done."
Yeah.
Quickly, I think we should just run through like the actual news of what this is, just for anybody who didn't get to see the stream but is watching the podcast. We are getting all four raids back. I mean, obviously, Wrath of the Machine is currently a current raid, but not only are they all coming back to 390 Lite, but they're also going to be featured in a weekly playlist with one raid a week featured in that playlist. And that,
I love that idea.
Yeah,
I do too. When that raid is featured. There's going to be all challenge modes enabled. So it's not like one challenge mode a week. All challenge modes in that raid are enabed. And that includes Vault of Glass and Crota's End, which previously did not have challenge modes. So those are being added to those two raids. There's going to be any gear that you get out of these raids is going to drop at potentially max light. If you're 400 light, it's going to drop at max light. Mm-hmm. So you'll be able to use it right away. Is there anything else about the raids that we should
They're going to be generous. They're retooling the drop rates.
They didn't note that they are going to be generous in the drop rates.
Yeah. The loot itself is changing a little bit. There's going to be ornaments for Wrath of the Machine is getting another ornament slot put on that gear. There's going to be ornaments for Vault of Glass. We don't know if it's like for every piece of gear, but I think they showed the helm. I think we can guess that the boots will have some sort of. It'll probably be all of them too. Mm-hmm. In all honesty, it'll probably be all of them.
Yeah.
And then also as a reward for finishing a raid when it's the weekly featured raid, you'll get a Age of Triumph package that will contain an ornament in it.
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't actually get to watch the stream as it was going live because I was flying back home. But yeah, there's a lot of good stuff in there about the raid.
Yeah, I got to also included to watch it live, and it was interesting to, have you ever felt that burning sensation like you grab on a pan and it hurts, right? Like mm-hmm.
Being burned.
Like being burned. I felt a lot like that watching it. I don't know. Like I had it was like I was being roasted alive. I just
you were.
Like holy a rotisserie shit. Style.
Like yeah, rotisserie. Like you're over a hot flame and you're just slowly being turned like a stuck pig, I don't know. I mean, I don't know what that's I kinda know what that's like now. I mean, I feel like that really
I thought it was awesome. I'm not going to lie. Like, it was hilarious. The Deej came at you specifically with both barrels. Mm-hmm. He was deleting the Titan helmet, the exotic Titan helmet, and he just called it out, man. I wish this was Pope.
Yeah, you know, and I don't even know how this really started. I can only think back. Yeah, I can. I don't know if anybody who watches the podcast knows this about me, but I can kind of be a troll sometimes.
No.
Sometimes.
For real?
Sometimes. Yeah. For every once in a while. And sometimes I like to tweet at Deej, you know. I like to tweet at Deej and maybe troll him for being the leader of the Warlocks.
What was the second thing he said, too? Because he wasn't done. He did that at the beginning of the show.
He did it multiple times.
And then later in the show, he's like, what did he say exactly?
He's just, you know, about deleting characters.
I think it was more deleting characters.
Oh, yeah. Pope deletes characters. You know who deletes a lot of characters?
You know who deletes characters?
Pope.
Pope deletes characters.
And then when the other guy's on the couch, yeah, he should.
Yeah, he should.
Yeah, he did. Well,
and the thing that hurt me the most out of all this, you know, Elliot Gray, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so I respect that guy. I like him, you know? I like his work, and I respect him. And he got on this. He jumped on it on Twitter, and he messaged out. He sent out some messages. We know we need to save this community. We need to, you know, banish this man from the lands. You know, it's just like
much respect for Elliot from that. Yeah, gosh. Well, that guy's awesome. I need to meet him.
And then Cosmo put out a tweet that's asked for who's, are you team Deej or you're team Pope? And like 70% of people voted for team Deej.
That's me. That's me.
That's I voted for him too.
See? I voted for him, but then I said I was with him. I'm with Pope.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the only thing.
That was hilarious. I mean, that just shows how much Deej really likes you, though. Really, in all honesty.
Well, it's fun to know that we have a community manager that has a sense of humor and is plugged into our community. He knows the kind of sense of humor I have, and knew that it was okay to engage with me that way. You know, to mess with me, and it's just part of what makes this community special. I mean,
I thought that was really fun.
It was a lot of fun.
It was hilarious to watch too.
And I love the kind of awkward silence that the guys on the couch had when he made some of the comments. They're like, is it okay to roast Pope like this? And they're like,
yeah, it is.
Yeah, sure it is.
So, yeah. Moving on from the Pope roast, there's a lot of other stuff that happened.
I want to talk about that Age of Triumph book a little bit.
Well, wait, hold up.
Reward book. They showed off.
Hold up. Before we talk about that, on the raid stuff, because we were talking about raids, they mentioned four challenge modes that are coming. One for Templar.
Oh, yeah.
One for Atheon, as they said it. And then...
That's wrong. They mispronounced it.
They mispronounced it, yeah. Yeah. itself. It's not Atheon. It's Atheon. Come on now. What are the two challenges going to... Obviously, Crota, and then what else? Like the
I think it's got to be crossing the bridge, right? It's got to be.
Yeah.
It wouldn't be the Death Singer, would it?
Well, you know how many people never really did the bridge the right way?
It is surprising.
Yeah. I mean,
every time there's usually one person.
They jumped up on the roof and they did the things that they did to avoid that fight altogether, right? Because it was literally easier to just skip it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I think that they're going to make the bridge. Have to do the engagement.
Let's talk about the raids then before we get to the
book.
Because. There is a lot to talk about that they revealed here. They said they are making some changes to the raids, too. So, you know, like cheeses like that could be getting eliminated. Hopefully, in my opinion, hopefully they do get eliminated.
They said they were going to.
They said they were going to get rid of cheeses, and they were also just dusting up some stuff. Like the confluxes maybe are a little too long. So there's, or no, it was the oracles are slightly too long. They're going to shrink the timing on that or maybe reduce a few of them. So there's some minor tweaks that they're doing, but nothing like Sivifying or Takeifying.
Yeah, it's still going to have the feel of the original raid, but they're just tuning it up a little bit.
Yeah.
Right. Giving it a facelift.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, I expect all the cheeses possible. Those will be gone. I think it's going to be really interesting to see what they actually do with these challenge modes. Yeah?
Well, I'm telling you, some of these raids... You know, I think we're underestimating them because we're so used to doing them over light. But I think they're going to be tough as hell.
So challenge mode for the first encounter could be not triggering any of the lamps.
Damn. That sounds like a long incursion.
Sounds like
would they do something where they did not include the mechanic of the?
Well, I mean, think about it. You could add the lamps in because that's what they like wanted, or maybe only a certain amount of lamps could be triggered, or I don't know. Maybe trigger every lamp, but it seems like you do that anyway.
No, you can definitely skip lamps.
Yeah, you can skip them, but usually some people end up hitting every single lamp.
Challenge modes, they like to get everybody involved in challenge modes, you're right? It's like everybody has to participate to do a challenge mode. So, like,
well, what if everybody needed to be on that sync plate at the end of at the top of the lamps?
That's interesting.
You know, that center.
Yeah.
That could work.
Or they just remove that rock that's near it.
Right. Which one? Just like delete. Every single rock.
There's like three rocks that you can.
There's a lot of speculation we could do on that. I think Crota, that fight could have a lot of different.
Yeah. What do you think we can do with
challenge
Crota?
Modes to it?
I'm going to say for Crota, only one you can only hold the sword once. Like
everybody's got to hold the sword, right?
Not everyone, but a different one. Because, like, I don't think there's enough. Is there enough damage phases? You have to be.
There could
really,
be.
You have to be very.
Right,
very,
it's going
to
be a different level. Could be.
They get adjust his health based on the challenge.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, that's a light dusting.
Yeah, true.
That's more of like a polish and a rub.
Polish and
dusting, polish, rub. They go hand in hand.
A little rubbing it down a little.
I wouldn't know anything about that. Anyway, moving on to like, what do you think Atheon could probably be?
I think
they said that's going to be the hardest.
You have to shove them off the platform
with the warlock. I like that.
They go back.
No, they said specifically that Atheon.
Atheon. I'm not going to say
They said Atheon was going to, I don't want to say Atheon. Atheon is going to be their hardest challenge yet.
Yeah, Meg. Let's see.
Is that going to be the last raid they do for the weekly stuff, or is it going to be the second one?
Okay, hold up. Challenge mode?
Did they say that specifically?
Yeah. It's the second one, yeah.
They said there was the weekly order up.
Yeah, it's going to go Crota than Fog. I think here's a possibility. You can do it without having Atheon's revenge or whatever, or Time's revenge. So they might make it so you have to do all the damage without Time's revenge. So as soon as you get teleported, you just run through and don't kill any of the oracles. You know, so if you don't kill the oracles, you can run out of the teleport and it's okay. You just don't get Time's revenge.
Oh, okay.
But it makes it a lot harder. Because you have to do significantly more DPS.
Yeah, you got to do a ton.
But if you stack tethers and all that, it might be doable.
Man, that's he's going to be at our light, and we're going to have to do significantly more DPS.
Well, I remember. I don't know, man. No, it's possible. I remember Datto. Datto did it with Deej in the raid. I think it was was on stream. Deej. Yeah, they did that on stream a while back.
I've had to do it because it glitched out and it wouldn't teleport anybody to the
They just had to kill it. Yeah.
Yeah.
What about the center platform and using the shield?
You have to use the shield though to get rid of the thing that
But I'm trying to think of how they would do a challenge mode on Athena.
How about no bullets penetrate it? Either way. Yeah. Like rockets don't, you know? Like, the guy shot a rocket inside of there, thinking it was going to hit Atheon with it?
That'd be debatable.
Yeah, maybe.
They wouldn't change the mechanics of it just for the challenge mode.
Something about when you teleport, I like what Tefty's saying, something about having to do with something where you teleport.
Yeah. I feel like without Time's Vengeance would be the, or when Guardians make their own fate, I feel like that would be the, that would be the best one.
Definitely be challenging.
That'd be challenging.
What do you guys think about Crota being the first raid?
I'm surprised
by that. Obviously, I expected it to be
surprised by it.
I feel like they're doing that to kind of show the community that there are changes coming to some of these because that's
you
a
think
one
this
that
is
would
the
be,
most changed one.
Yeah, this might be the most changed one just to get people kind of acclimated to it.
Mm-hmm. And how do you guys feel about this being it for Destiny?
Totally fun.
Yeah. Fun.
Make Destiny 2.
Yep, exactly. Yeah. Like
Patrick is a mainly PvP player. You're not a little bit upset that there's not going to be this is. No. I mean, this is a PvE focused update. It would seem.
Yeah, we've also had look, PvP gets the lion's share of these updates.
For sure.
And it's, people have been requesting this type of update for a very long time. People want the raids to be up. People want to have more reasons to go do PvE type activities. This, and then everything else is coming with this update. There's still going to be stuff for PvP players to do. There are still portions of the Rise of Iron booklet, which we'll talk about in a little bit, that are PvP oriented. So it's fine.
We are going to get a balance patch as well.
Yeah.
Nice, Pope.
Did Pope really just fall out of his chair?
Yes, he did. Oh.
Cut him off. He's had too much.
The roast was that strong.
Oh, damn.
Wow.
Oh. Blessus, you said earlier that you kind of you started raiding in Destiny a little bit later. How much time did you spend in Vog and Dark Below or Crota's End?
Personally, it took me a lot of fails. Like what I did is me and my one friend, I would always just whip out my phone and download a Destiny LFG app, and we would try to find five people, and it would take forever. It was a lot of fails, and so if I got to Urya and like just pray for a Hawk Moon, and that would be my thing. So, and that would never happen. We'd wipe on Crota and I'd be like, well, time to LFG again. And after that, I kind of stopped raiding. Skolas was almost impossible for me. It was really
bad. You excited to see this stuff come back then?
Yeah, because now I think it's going to be easier for me to grab some people. And I'm really excited for it because I get to really experience the raids like I didn't really do. So this is cool for me. I'm not looking forward to King's Fall, though. Not one bit.
Well, I'm excited to do these raids at higher light with new weapons that we have now.
Right.
Right? Yeah. We have new weapons, more weapons to go back and do and be able to figure out these challenging...
Yeah, we'll have a Year 3 Fatebringer, a Galahorn, and Black Hammer.
Yeah, done.
I'm excited for Black Hammer. Totally I wonder if they're going to change that, though.
I wonder, too, if
they're going to change it. Don't change Black Hammer.
They might.
I'll riot.
I mean,
one thing I was really curious about was if there's going to be a quest to tie everything together. Like the speaker's like, hey, you do this, this, and this, and maybe there's something else. I don't know. I was just curious about that.
It does appear there's going to be a cutscene involving the speaker. Whether or not we've seen the whole thing,
right? I hope not.
Kind of up for question.
Don't spoil it.
Yeah, they definitely talked about how there's going to be more than just ornaments coming from those weekly rituals. So. Yeah, we're going to get ornaments for the raid gear, but at the same time, there's going to be some changes to or whatever type of drops that we get. And I wonder how much retooling they're going to do to the actual loot. It kind of sounded like they understood that it's on a sacred level and they shouldn't touch it too much, which is good. But I wouldn't be surprised if there was some, we had to change this because it was ultimately going to break everything type of stuff.
Yeah, I feel like we'll see some sort of change to Black Hammer. Like if they just make it a legendary version of Black Spindle.
It's like, why use Black Spindle ever?
Why use Black Spindle? and then if Fatebringer comes back, it's we can go back to the old year one Holy Trinity of Fatebringer, Black Hammer, and Galahorn.
Yeah. I mean, that's going to be my raid loadout, right? I guess the only one that it would change is for King's Fall, where I might switch to a scout.
Well,
are the elementals back, or is that
not confirmed?
Well, they talked about elemental primaries. They talked about it as like they almost hinted that it would come back, but we have evidence that like screenshots that show that they didn't come back in the form of the Fatebringer. Player mentioned that. Sorry,
we will know. They specifically said we will know during the sandbox update. So not next week, but the week after.
Okay.
So. Once that comes, all our questions will be answered.
And I know they, but it made it sound like that we are going to get some back.
Yeah, they were talking about that. Elemental primaries, they mentioned it, so I'd be surprised if they completely took it out.
There's also like the Vex Mythic class, which, like it'd be hard to imagine how they could even make that gun without it being elemental.
Completely agree.
Yeah, you've got an example of a specific primary that has an elemental arc damage, now. Right. And
no, I believe they said Vex will have the elemental thing on it on the stream. I didn't watch it, but everything that I read said that it would be on there, but we don't know about legendary primaries.
Pat, definitely sounds like hearsay.
Pat, you did not watch it.
It entirely could be.
You're sounding like Donald Trump now. Like, this friend of mine.
I heard from a reliable source.
this friend of mine told me that things are going bad.
There was a publication I read, and they said definitely possibly.
Bob told me that stuff's bad in Paris.
The weather is moving in tonight, guys. That's not hearsay. I'm literally hearing lightning and thunder rumble outside my window. So if my computer cuts out, it's not me just it's not just me quitting or anything like that. Last week.
For the people in chat, I didn't fall.
Yes,
I strategically laid my chair down.
Strategically
applied clumsiness into my chair fall.
This is not my fault. This is Patrick's fault. Okay? Do you understand
keep
that?
Keep blaming your problems on others. Look, keep blaming your problems on others.
All right, let's get back to the raids here. I wanted to talk about the raids themselves, because I got to tell you, I am excited to play the raids again at their new light and get all that old stuff again.
Me too.
But I've been there and I've done that. There's seemingly nothing new here, right? Nothing.
There seems to
be nothing. It's a send-off.
And I'm happy to go back into those old raids. I'm sure it'll last.
New armor-ish. His new looks.
That I don't have vault space for.
Right? Well, and they confirmed no more vault space.
Yeah. So it's like, it is a little bit bittersweet. Like, I'm glad to see the old raids coming back, especially the Vault of Glass. But, you know, on a scale of like 0 is no hype and 10 is like all the hype, like, man, this is around a 5 for me. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Here, again, this is my perspective. If they were like, something else is coming after this, then I'd be on that same vibe with you. But because I know that this is finally the end, the button up, it's been an awesome nearly 3 years getting to play this version of Destiny, that makes me very excited. I'll have a great time reminiscing about old stuff and getting to recollect some of that gear again. But the fact that I know that D2 is coming is enough fuel for me.
It's around the corner. Yeah. Right? Yeah. It's like, it seems like a long way away now, but like, we're gonna be in June, like, in a heartbeat, watching E3.
Yeah.
And then the summer is going to go by and we'll be playing D2 in September.
Yeah. And you're going to be shooting things.
Alpha and betas.
Yeah.
Hopefully. But I'd always rather see, like, I felt this way about the spring update last year too, is like, yeah, that's cool, but I'd rather see new stuff for sure.
Oh yeah. We're all in that same boat. Yeah. We want to see D2, honestly. But the fact is they do need to send this version of Destiny off with,
How cool would it be if they sent out Destiny 1 with like a story, though, right? Like a story like that...
Shaxx in the tower with Cabal?
They said this was the last live update, so I'm guessing we're not going to see some sort of heralding event in the game.
I would like to see more, and I know we have a couple more live streams where they're going to talk about more stuff, so I'm hoping that we get some, you know, fantastic, you know, little piece of nugget of something that we'll get to enjoy that kind of wraps up. I know what you're saying, Briar. Even if it's like a cutscene that kind of like ties up some of the storyline. Mm-hmm. I'd like to
it's gonna
see
be
something
a long ass cutscene.
I know.
Right. Well, like, something that like ties a little bit up at Destiny 1, but really like shoots us into Destiny 2. You know, like a cliffhanger type ending that just like, holy shit, I can't believe that just happened. I can't wait to play Destiny 2.
That's going to require an actual story though to set that up. And you know, the story,
God forbid we get story, right?
No, but the story in this game is the joke is very real, but it's also reality at the same time. Like, how are they going to
All you need is one line. I have time to explain.
Yeah. Exactly.
That could work.
I have time to explain, and then the camera cuts out, and then you're like, Destiny 2.
I have time to... Rise Camille, take that as, I have time to pay... I have time to explain if you pay another $60 for another game.
Breaking the third wall.
You know what they could do? And this would be... I think it would be pretty simple for them. They could do an update at the very end that has an outro... cinematic there. You know how they clicked on those things in the directory? Yeah. They could just have the like end of, you know, or a Destiny 2 intro, whatever kind of post cinematic for D1, you know, that you could click on that would be the final patch, the final update of Destiny. That's possible.
It'd be so much cooler to get a mission, though.
Yeah. But Briar,
I'm holding out hope for a mission. And I'll tell you why. Look at the Thwab.
Thwab.
Oh, that went live.
Thwab.
All right. There is a comment in the Thwab about...
Thwab.
Oh, God. Where is it?
I completely forgot about the Thwab.
There is a comment in there about light. A light...
question? Is it one of the questions?
I'll have to find it.
All right. Okay. You go find it. I kind of want to talk about the record book now.
Let's do it.
Yeah.
Let's move into the record book. So just not on this one, but how do you guys like how they've been doing the record books thus far? Like, we saw it in Moments of Triumph, the original one. We saw it for Rise of Iron. Now we got one for this. What do you guys think about record books just in general?
I like it. Yeah.
I never completed it, but it's, I don't know, I enjoy it. It's like a little check mark.
Mm-hmm. That's why I like it. It's a nice little, it's goalpost that you can move towards and be like, I did that. Great, I did that. Oh, this is an exotic right there I need to pick up. I can do more heroic strikes for this check mark and all that, yeah? I like it.
I think they're okay. I feel like they're leaning really hard on it with a 13-page one.
13 pages.
That you don't have to 100%.
Yeah, you don't have to 100% it.
That's true. But you're going to, right?
But if you don't 100% that 13 pager, you know, don't call me in the morning. All right.
Are you going to be positive that you're getting that like super cool thing? You'll get most of it.
How many of you guys have been actually collecting ships?
Not me.
Every time I see a Reddit post that says this ship has not been available for 256 days, I go directly over and I buy it.
Oh, you did? So Briar's pretty much the only one. Okay, I started my PSN account in the Dark Below era because I was Xbox, 100% Xbox in the beginning. So the only console that I'll be possible to 100% everything is the Xbox for me.
Okay. So it's not so much the act of complete and all the, well, I guess it is. It's like, it's the way it's just a list of things to do, right? It's not, it's not in the game. It's not like a quest giver giving you like missions to complete. It's just a book with shit to do in it. You know, it's good that there's something to do. It's good that there's something to go after. It's just the way that it's presented in small doses. It doesn't bother me as much, but 13 pages of it seems like, man, that's just a lot of me looking at this book and then going to complete a task.
Well, this is the last live update. So instead of giving you some small, they're going to just plop this, you know, codex in front of you and say, okay, there you go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's how I look at it. And that's why I say it's not a ton of new content. It's a celebration of the content that we played. Mm-hmm. Because the community is still very active in wanting to play this game. So I look at it as it's a celebration. It's like, hey, go send off the end of this game with a book that you can check mark all the stuff to essentially get yourself ready for Destiny 2. That's how it feels.
Yeah. You know, I'll definitely be doing the book. I'll definitely be buying the t-shirt, you know. Like, I wonder how much of that book I'm just going to, like, immediately fill out as soon as I get it. Because some of that stuff, a lot of that stuff is just... You know,
I found it.
Already done.
Found it.
Okay. What was the line?
It says, he's talking about the too long won't watch mission brief. So he's talking about it's after the bullet points. There's a line right above the screen cap that says, next week we're talking about weekly rituals and we'll play a strike bathed in light.
Okay.
What does that mean?
That means they're going to play a strike that...
Don't say bathed in light.
It's bathed in light
on Mercury.
Say it one more time for me.
Next week, we're talking about the weekly ritual, so the next live stream, and we'll play a strike bathed in light. I'm thinking that we might make it a new strike.
It's possible, actually.
No. I don't think so.
No, it's possible.
Come on, Patrick.
Every update has had, almost every update has had something of that level. Yeah, I mean, they could give us something, a story strike to tie things together. I don't... It's pretty lofty.
Be awesome.
It's It's pretty lofty to be able to tie everything together, though.
How is that lofty, though? Come on, is that really that lofty?
Is lofty?
They said they were
to tie the story together.
Yeah, to tie the story together. Fuck no. But for the
Mayhem Strikes,
the Mayhem Strike thing that Deej was talking about. Like that's, he said we've added more mayhem to Strikes.
That
bathed in light. That I feel like that's probably.
Didn't they mention something about Nightfalls too?
No, yeah. They said Mayhem Nightfalls. What was that about adding some mayhem to Nightfalls? That's what the mayhem goes to. It doesn't talk about mayhem strikes.
Strikes are Nightfalls. You know, Nightfalls are strikes. Mm-hmm. Bathed in light. That makes sense.
Why did the Thwob need to be like this?
Because Deej likes flowery prose and he likes watching you get really frustrated.
Well, Warlocks. That's true.
If we had a hunter doing this...
I know. When we had Cosmo doing weekly update, he was like, here's the bullet points of the stuff that you get. This is exactly what it means. Got to get... Boom. Done.
All right.
How would a Titan make that weekly update? I'm just curious.
It would be mainly pictures.
It would be carved in stone.
Carved in stone.
There would be a lot of writing. Face every time you read it.
I like that, Pope.
Here art thou.
There would be just lots of like screenshots, you know, with as very little writing as possible.
So are you guys excited about the book? Like, is this an exciting way for you to spend time over the summer?
I think it's fun. Yeah.
The one thing I'm curious about is if if those are the only emblems that carry over to Destiny 2.
That's what I want to know too.
Do you think you think there are going to be emblems to carry over? Because they said, they basically said no nothing. Gear. And here's my reasoning for this. I think that emblems and shaders overall are going to look completely different in Destiny 2.
Yes.
Like they're not going to be horizontal like that. They're potentially going to have three dimensions and have different.
What if they're all animated and like have your Elo like dripping off of them? You know,
exactly. To show how sweaty you are.
Redesigned.
I don't want to see my Elo dripping off anything.
You'd be like, this is a sweaty player. Like,
yeah,
they have a chance to just completely redesign the emblem system, completely redesign the shader system. It doesn't have to be three colors in a circle anymore. It could be whatever they feel is necessary for Destiny 2.
Exactly.
If they decide they want to bring stuff forward from Destiny 1 to Destiny 2, then yeah, it has to accommodate the old systems. But if they just draw a line, then it could be anything they want.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, it opens up way more potential for them to do animated, to do all kinds of scenario based type of emblems. Like it's way more possible. Also shaders that potentially aren't just the whole thing. Like let's say it's four pieces of color components that you can find to assemble the type of look, you know, like it could be a lot more than just one
custom
shader.
Shaders.
Yeah. Custom shaders.
Yeah. Shaders for each individual piece of equipment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
All sorts of stuff they can do.
I'm okay with the rewards not transferring over because if anything, if you get to rank 7, you can also buy a t-shirt.
Oh yeah.
Just like last
t-shirt.
Time.
T-shirt.
which you won't have to you won't have to get 100% complete on the book to be able to buy the t-shirt.
Yeah.
Yeah, they said
it's like I think they said it's like 75% or something.
Yeah.
Well, so which here's something interesting that came out through the Thwob inside of the. I usually skip through this section because it. Well, not skip through. I just don't read it as carefully. Mm. The What's Up Doc. So, there's a really interesting piece here that I came up in the live stream that I thought we should bring up, and it goes over some nuances on deleted characters because I was really interested in that.
You happen to be an aficionado of deleting characters.
Just recently, it's
all account based. So if you did something on a deleted character, no,
not really. Some of it's not.
Yeah, some of it's
not. So there's a commemorations page. So will I receive credit on the commemorations page of the Age of Triumph record book for participating in previous Destiny releases if I've deleted a character? And the answer is yes. But only on the same account. So so the commemorations page, which is how soon you started playing Destiny, right? So since I started playing in the beta, right?
Right.
It's going to account link that, not character link it.
Right.
So yeah, all the Triumph nodes, it's good.
Why did you
so
say
all
the not Triumph, really account based?
Well, because no. I'm sorry. I thought you said class based or like character based.
No, it's account based.
I apologize. Yes, you're right. Briar, I apologize. You're a Titan. You're always right.
Thank you, Pope.
Second. I will receive credit for participating in previous Destiny releases if I've upgraded from a legacy. So they talked about some really important if you went from a PlayStation 3 to a PlayStation 4 or an Xbox 360 to an Xbox One and you properly linked your consoles, you'll get that credit. And they said, will Briar finally get his vault space? Hell no. Tell him to stop crying like a baby. It's right there. I'm just reading it.
Word for word.
Harsh. I don't have it pulled up, so I'm going to take his word for it. It's the only time I'm going to take Pope's word for it. Yeah.
Like, I mean, I knew that they weren't going to increase vault space. I didn't know that because Bungie told me. I just was getting that feeling because even though they said with the release of Rise of Iron that that was an issue they were looking at in the future, I mean, it just, like, over time, I was just getting that feeling. Like, they're not going to do anything. But this is a big problem because we've got 4 raid sets that we're going to add. I know that I've deleted all of my Dark Below sets. You know, like, there's a lot of new gear that's got to be added to that vault. So we're going to have to make some really tough decisions on what you want to keep and what you don't. And, you know, I understand why Bungie doesn't want to devote the resources, like, server-side and client-side to, like, fixing that issue for players. But that doesn't mean it doesn't suck for players. That does suck.
Yeah. I do want to point out that we haven't heard so there's still 2 more reveal streams, and it's possible that they do finally bring in raid kiosks. It's possible. I'm not saying it's going to happen. I'm just saying because they're going to...
They said no.
Oh, did they say no raid kiosks on that also?
Yes, right here. It says, will there be an increase to vault space? No. The following things that Briar has asked for, he will not get. But these things, these previous Destiny updates, were the final storage solutions implemented for Destiny.
Got it.
Exotic weapons, exotic armor, ships, shaders. Yeah, the final countdown.
Okay, I didn't know. Like I said, I didn't read the TWAB, so that was my bad. That's too bad, honestly, because there is an absolute ton of gear. But Bungie wants you to pick what you want to keep and have to go and recollect things if you feel bad about it. So
that doesn't feel triumphant.
No,
I don't feel like an age of triumph on that. Goddamn.
Yeah, I don't feel triumphant at all. But apparently, it's supposed to be raining like manna from heaven, so you're not gonna miss it for long.
Yeah, that is true. So you can just toss it.
Assuming like most of the VOG gear is the same as the year one stuff, that's an easy decision. I'll just delete the year one stuff and upgrade to the year two stuff. But in specific examples, like if the helmet is a different model. Man, I like that Titan helmet from year one. I think that's a really cool helmet. And it was a bitch to earn it.
Yeah, the helmets were so, very rare.
I don't want to delete it, you know?
Yeah.
I don't
well,
know.
Well, we're tying the end of it. We're saying goodbye to a chapter. And yeah. I'm with Tepti on this. I like being able to go back and have some good laughs with friends and play the old content and get some new light level. I see the reason for that. I see the reason why they're doing this. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. My real question is, when is the trailer for D2?
Exactly.
Well, I want to know.
Mm. And will it feature Led Zeppelin?
Yeah,
I know.
Yes.
So
Led Zeppelin needs their money.
I have a spin foil hat theory. What if you're saving that trailer for someone to get 100% in the record book? They go to the Triumph thing. They put in like what you need to put in to get the thing.
Yeah.
Goes to a blank screen. All of a sudden. Someone has the world first trailer shared that way.
That'd be cool. That'd be awesome.
That sounds
just hear immigrant song.
That's a great idea. And if Bungie wants to steal it right now and use it, they're welcome to.
Royal
it.
You release please. That?
You release it? The idea?
Oh, go ahead. Go. Do it. Give me the trailer. Anything to speed up the process.
Yeah.
How many days do you think is going to take for someone to hit that 100%? When we hear that first person hit that 100%.
At least 4 weeks, because I think you have to do something for each raid ritual, right?
Oh, do you?
Okay.
I think.
So it'll be done 4 weeks? on that Tuesday of that fourth week.
I could be wrong, but it seems like they're tying it to these weekly rituals, and there's going to be at least a 4-week rotation.
We've never seen time-gated stuff here on Destiny at all.
Ever.
So... Ever.
Not Rise once. Of Iron didn't have that much time gated stuff though. I was really surprised by that.
It's true, actually.
They got a lot of pushback from that on in the Taking.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like a lot.
Yeah.
Like a lot.
Like that one heavy.
Like, what the hell are you doing, Bungie?
Yeah. Even though I thought it was fucking awesome, like waking up every morning and like reading Reddit and like, oh shit, You gotta go on, to this place to go get the black spindle. I'm there.
I was on Reddit every day during those days. I'm just there, like, what am I gonna see this stuff?
As a player, I liked it because it always felt like there was something. If I wasn't as connected, like, to, you know, the community as I was, it'd be like, oh, well, what's this? Oh, it's this event. When does that happen? Cool. And then, like, then you learn about it. As a content creator, I hated it because it completely trashed my sleep schedule for about a 2 month period of time.
See, I loved it because there was always something fucking exciting to be talking about.
It's true.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, the Taken King was a great time. Like, that right up till, I'd say, Christmas, maybe right up until the PlayStation Experience where Sparrow Racing League was announced. But, like, from the releases Taken King to that time, that was exciting. There was something new every week, and it was cool.
Mm-hmm. And with Taken King, like, I always was curious, how did those people get Twilight Garrison early? And, like, you had, like, the shaky cell phone thing, like, hey, I got Twilight Garrison on my Xbox 360. I was like, what?
It was,
and, like, that kept everyone, like, how do you get it? Yeah. It must be out there.
I can't remember how it it was, I believe they got it from Ingrams. And it was so they patched it so quickly that there were only like three people that got those chess pieces.
Mm-hmm, I gotcha.
Do you guys think? I mean, I'm assuming this is coming back because we're getting Vex and Necrochasm. But do you think Pocket Infinity is going to get its brush over as well?
Yeah, I think it's coming back.
Yeah,
or do you think? Are you asking if it gets changed or if it comes back?
I'm assuming they're going to change it a little bit if they're going to bring it up to an acquirable level right now. But what if they don't? I mean, there's also talk, you know, like in chat, people talking about Dubious Volley and all that. Like, do you think it's possible they might bring Dubious Volley in finally, or if it's completely scrapped and never going to make it?
Well, if it's built, I would say throw it in there at this point.
Yeah.
Like, if it's a completed weapon and they decided to hold it back for some reason.
That's possibly one of the rewards. Like an RNG drop of possibly getting Pocket Infinity from the weekly ritual stuff.
Mm. Be cool.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and then that gun wouldn't be as overpowered as it used to be with the new special ammo economy either.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you definitely get a kill with it probably when you finally pick up that
kill, right?
A kill.
A kill every 30 seconds because you had to go get new ammo every time you fired it.
Do you guys think they're going to, like, add in another chest to Vault of Glass just because?
They specifically addressed it there.
So you didn't watch the... They talked about that.
No.
And they said they are not allowed to touch that at all. And apparently only two people in the world actually know how many chests are in there. And Luke Smith and I can't remember the other person.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you think that's a myth or do you think that's real?
I think it's real.
Like, how many chests?
I think it's real, too.
Yeah. I think it's real that, like, only they know. Because Bungie's notorious about secrets like that. Like, look at the Halo 3 secret. Like, that's the one, you know, one time a year, the birthday message.
No, that was the original Halo secret.
No, I think that wasn't Halo 3.
That was Halo 1. Halo
3 as well.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's Halo 3.
It'd be hilarious if we're all playing Destiny 5 on our
guys, I found the chest! I found the
fucking last chest! Yeah, seriously, all of a sudden on Reddit one day, days. Somebody pops up and says, I found the fucking last chest!
Yeah, Bungie loves their secrets, and they do not tell.
Yeah, so, no, they don't. They're tight-lipped.
Yeah.
You know what
we want to talk about?
No, there's one thing that I'm not tight-lipped about.
Do it.
These wild mics and headphones. There's no doubt you've seen these wild mics and headphones I'm using. They're just some of the iconic gear that Blue creates. I'm doing this from memory because I don't actually have it pulled up. That was about as far as I could get. Yep. One of these days.
Wow, Patrick.
I know.
Microphone.
One of these days. Blue's award-winning products are the driving force behind professional musicians, internet creators, and countless elite gaming teams and Twitch streamers. Their Yeti USB mic is the internet's most popular microphone. Their MoFi and Lola, actually, their Sadie and Lola headphones deliver insane sound in a very personalized fit. Blue offers everything you need to completely immerse yourself in the ultimate gameplay experience. Learn more about Blue at bluemic.com.
Looking forward to getting those Sadies.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
They sound so good.
They do sound good. And I gotta say, I still use my MoFis. They're wonderful. When I was going to Seattle, you know, just put these on and it's like I'm not even on a plane full of babies.
They got those new ones out. I don't think they're out yet, but they're more portable, and they got Bluetooth and noise canceling.
Yeah, they're not out yet, I believe.
Yeah, they're not out yet, but man, they look nice. It's a different look for blue headphones, but they look good.
I need new headphones.
I ordered a pair just like the ones you're wearing, Briar.
The Lolas?
Yeah.
Yep.
And I'm excited for those.
Yeah, I like the Lolas. I like the Lolas better than the MoFi, personally. They don't have the sound amplification in them, but they're lighter and a little more comfortable, especially in the headband.
Nice.
I like them a lot. They sound great too.
And they can plug in and out of like the phone charger, right? Like you can use it off of like it's just a regular headphone. Yeah,
that's awesome.
Yeah, they come with like a 20-foot cable too, which my cat chewed through.
Oh no!
Yeah, I killed the cat. Don't worry, everything's cool. Good.
Let's move some Twitter questions. God.
All right. I don't know if it's all the excitement of, you know, the reveal stream or if it's the fact that Blessious is coming on, but goddamn, we got a shit ton of questions this week.
Nice.
I got 6 pages here, woo! Which I doubt we'll get through, but I could have done another 6 pages. So I'm sorry if I didn't get to your question. We just had so many and a lot of them were really good. We're going to start off with McGee the Beast, who says, how many holy tacos does Bless give the announcement for Age of Triumph?
Oh, five. Five holy tacos. Yeah, five holy tacos.
Out of how many? Out of how many?
Out of five. Five out of five.
That's good. Yeah. That's a lot of holy tacos.
Yeah.
What makes a holy taco? Is it like blessed by the Pope?
Pope Bear
or
himself?
Blessed by you?
Pope blessed the tacos.
Pope Bear.
Oh, Pope Bear.
Every taco that comes out.
That's a big meal right there.
Billy Buntbeard says, would love to hear a quick dialogue between Walken and Varix if Holtzmann would oblige.
Oh my gosh.
What do you mean? Holtzmann will oblige. Varix always waiting. Yes.
Wow, waiting. Waiting for what? Yes.
Waiting for a new ship, Christopher. I've been waiting for you to see me in the reef.
Wow. I've been to a reef in the Bahamas, but, whoa, I didn't push you off no boat.
What is Bahamas?
Place on Earth, yes. You get a suntan.
Yes.
Nice.
Nice job, Good job, guys.
Wow.
Jason says, love the podcast. Bungie's going to recognize long-term players in Destiny 2. Will those come from the new record book? We don't know, right? We think there's going to be some. They've referenced these honors that will be given to players in Destiny 2 who were players of Destiny 1. We don't know exactly how those are achieved. I think it's a safe bet to try and do a good job on that book, though.
Yeah. I would imagine.
Tito says, will Destiny ever have one account for all platforms? Many are out on 100% completion because of upgrading or switching consoles. So you're not out if you upgraded consoles, but you may be out if you switched.
Yep.
Yeah, a lot of people are definitely out if they switch, which is really fucking frustrating. I really want it to be because not just as like a content creator, but you know, some people do have two consoles and it's like, oh, I just met this group of friends and they're on this one other, you know, they're on Xbox. Oh, but you know, my account's on PlayStation. I really hope that that's something that they can do going forward because I believe Xbox opened it up. Some are able to play like that. I know not some, like some games are able to be played like that.
Right.
Yeah. Gears of War.
Yeah. I think everyone.
Resident Evil too, right?
I mean, even things like, Rocket League.
Did your friend Bob tell you about this, Patrick?
Did you hear this on the stream?
Did you hear this?
I can confirm
from a friend of yours. Did he talk to you about it?
This is a thing that happens. You can have one account between your console and your PC. Unfortunately, it's Microsoft and Sony that won't cooperate. And I think more Sony right now because they find themselves in a position of power and have no real financial reason to let that happen.
That's for cross play. And this is actually cross account. I'm really hoping.
True. And that's really in Bungie's hands.
Exactly. That is in Bungie's hands. They're totally capable of linking your PSN and your Xbox Live gamertag. So, and your PC, you know, whatever it's Steam or something like that. I really hope they do, because as someone who wants to play in all three platforms, assuming we do get a PC platform, I really, really hope they connect those, because 9 characters doesn't seem possible for me.
No. I've told you my plan before is I'm not doing 3 characters on any one platform. Dude. If it does end up being on 3 platforms, I'm doing 1 character per platform.
Yeah.
John Jensen says, what led all of you to stream? What did your families think? How did you explain it? Were finances a concern with them?
What led me to stream was just when I was working at Planet Destiny, they were like, hey, we want to start a stream. Can you research it? And I was like,
stream on the Planet Destiny channel.
Yeah. And I was like, okay, sure.
Yeah, I started streaming as well.
Yeah. Like, a lot of us here basically.
I think we all started that way.
It was like, we were obligated to because Planet Destiny wanted us to. And then we realized, this is a lot better, or this is really cool, because it's like we're making our own personal communities. I kind of want to do this for myself and not for a company. And then that's what spawned, us doing our own personal channels instead of just for Planet Destiny.
Well,
it was weird, though, because I feel like we got thrown into, like...
Oh, God, we did.
It was like your first streams are like, 300, 500, sometimes like 1,000, 2,000 people.
No one has that.
I don't even know how to work the fucking buttons yet.
I remember being Patrick, or it was Tefty, sent out the schedule, and I'm on it for like 3 or 4 days out of the week, and I'm like, whoa! Whoa! I got a job here, people.
Yeah, it's funny. I was.
Oh, man, that was fun.
I was very reluctant at first because of how much time would be involved. And I had seen streams, obviously, before. And both Memes and I had watched streams in the past and been like, oh, this is really cool. People are playing live in this chat and all that. But it wasn't until I actually got into streaming where I was like, this is amazing. I much prefer this form of content creation than YouTube, even though that's how I got started. So,
yeah, my dad doesn't understand what I do. He's like, play video games? What?
Even my friends don't really understand it. My wife does because she sees it happen on a daily basis, but my friends don't get it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I didn't address the family part. But like my family was very supportive of it. They're like, well, you're doing this other YouTube thing, and wait, so you just do this live now instead of editing it? Yeah. Okay.
Cool.
Cool.
Well, I know that my coworkers still haven't been able to fathom why somebody would pay $10,000 for this beard. You know, like, I know it
gets clearer to me every week as it grows.
I mean, I know that that's like, nice beard, that's man. Like, you know, was for the charity stream and stuff. But like when you wrap up the concepts of what happens during streaming and like the things that entertain people and, the connection you have with chat, I don't think that people who, like my family, doesn't understand it, you know, and very much so they don't understand it. But my wife, she sometimes hangs out here on the bed when I'm doing the podcast and just giggles at me and is in chat, you know, typing things. So it's I'm glad that she understands it. If chat sees her in her name is Lateral Drift, and she'll come in and chat every once in a while.
So, that's cool.
Yeah. For financially, It's always been for me, it's like the YouTube stuff and the Twitch stuff can take over more as they become more financially viable. The YouTube stuff really is much more financially viable for me personally than the Twitch stuff. And I do the Twitch stuff for fun. But as Twitch becomes more financially viable, then that can take up more of my time. But I've also always been blessed with a bit of hyperactivity where I just can't really sit still for long. So like, I don't miss like just sitting around on the couch. My wife doesn't like it because she sees me just like, you know, tapping on the, you know, like just being antsy. So she's always okay with me just like doing whatever.
Confirm.
As long as I'm not.
I can't sit down in one place for long. I have to be doing something.
Yeah.
That's why I love the Switch. You can just take it with you, man.
1-2
Switch.
It is
pretty cool.
1-2 Switch.
1-2 Switch. I love it. The milking game. It's a lot of fun.
I haven't played that.
I haven't played that.
It's tricky, actually. You gotta get the fingers just right. It's weird.
Yeah. Interesting.
Well, show me that again. How do you hold
it? How do you milk it?
You gotta do 1-2
right
full.
Right. Wait, no, I can't see you in the camera. It's you gotta
pick your hands right there. Yeah. Right. Yeah, like I don't know. I don't want to go into that. Like someone might screenshot that.
I
don't want to
screenshot it. I already have my finger on the button.
You gotta be careful what you say and like with that screen that capture piece. I mean, if you fall out of your chair, somebody's gonna snap that up.
Yeah.
And, oh yeah, that's gonna be a new sub emote clip. On my Monday on my channel.
Oh my god! I know this isn't Destiny related, but did you guys get a chance to play Zelda?
Oh my gosh!
Absolutely. Nope.
It hurts me that I can't play it more.
I want to.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm with you, Blessings. It hurts me literally. Like it hurts me that I'm not playing it more because I'm I just don't have time. And what else hurts is that I know Mass Effect is coming, I know that Age of Triumph is coming. It's like. Whew.
One back to back.
What the fuck is going on?
Horizon Zero Dawn is playing, is right now. Mm-hmm. So
yeah,
it's a good time. Good time for open.
It is a good time to be a gamer.
Yeah.
I'm saving my money right now because moving is going to obviously be expensive. So
yeah.
Buying a Nintendo Switch just.
You have a Wii U?
No, I don't have either.
Yeah.
Zelda is fun. It's like a lot of fun. And it's not going to become less fun if you play it next year.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah, I know. That's one of the cool things about it. Everything that I've seen is it's a game that kind of celebrates creativity in the player, mm-hmm. too. It doesn't hold your hand that much. Mm-hmm. So I'm looking forward to, I'm looking forward to like kind of having my own experience with it and just seeing what the hell happens in time. Not it's not in the cards for the next couple months.
That's fair.
Ocarina of Time?
Ocarina of Time, exactly. Mm. There's a few enemies in that game that are surprisingly difficult. Like it's almost like
it's a
page.
Tough game.
Yeah, it's almost a page out of Dark Souls, which is really cool. It's different from Zelda completely. Or past Zelda's. Yeah.
I love it.
Nice. I look forward to it.
In Dark Souls, you can't roll a bomb down a hill and kill everybody in like a village. Or there's like six enemies down there all standing next to exploding barrels. You just roll a fucking bomb down the hill and watch them die.
Oh man, thanks, Briar. Spoilers.
Jeff Williams says, "No vault space, what the fuck? How can they even begin to justify this? All these new gear sets and weapons."
So we found Briar's alternative Twitter account.
Yeah, that's like you, right?
Brian Roberts says, "Yeah, seriously, like you guys, am I the only one upset about this no vault space thing?"
There are plenty of people upset about it. For me, I'm just gonna let you be upset about it, and then that's enough for me.
My wife's upset that I've been yelling.
She's upset about you being upset. Goddamn. I've at this point, I've accepted the fact that there's no more vault space coming. Like, it happened a couple months ago. I was like, you know what? This is the space I have. My postmaster is perpetually packed on all three characters. This is the end of Destiny for me right now, for Destiny 1.
You just need to go through a delete-a-palooza and...
Hell no.
I just did that.
And you're back upped again?
I got like 10 free slots in both armor and weapons.
That sounds like a paradise.
That sounds amazing.
Yeah.
I can't even believe you right now. I'm so jealous.
Yeah, when I see that with the weapon thing say 100 out of 108, I'm like, okay, we got some space, guys. Whew.
Yeah. My postmaster's full, but I saw a picture of like original vault space and original
Oh
my gosh.
How could I ever do that?
But again, back in the day, you didn't get loot too often.
Yeah,
that's true.
And there wasn't that many varieties of stuff.
Yeah, a lot. And people keeping up with like three characters right at the beginning was, not that on her. It was difficult to do it anyway.
Yeah.
So,
I think a lot of people. I mean, for me, I recognized that Titans were the way to go, and I had three Titans.
Did you really?
Did that.
Oh yeah, yeah. I did the raid three times. For like at the beginning, I rolled every Titan. Yeah, I even got to a point because I had all the Titans that I would run the Titans through. I would delete two of the Titans and then restart them up again, get them to 40 or get them to that higher, rank them up.
Get them to 20.
And then put on the armor and then do the raids again for the loot. Okay. I was doing the raids like 4 to 6 times extra. A week.
Yeah, it was like the Nightfall strat too, because that's how you would farm a lot of exotics at the very start of the game.
I never did that. I've never deleted a character in Destiny. Aside from like alt accounts, like in my account, I've never deleted a character in Destiny. I've always had a warlock, a hunter, and a titan.
Same.
I started out with two hunters and a warlock because very quickly we were like, wow, Sunsinger locks are kind of broken in PvP. This is cool. And
PvE.
And PvE at the time. And then I realized, oh, I don't need two hunters. I'm just going to make a titan. Then I deleted my warlock because they were all...
It was a fucking warlock, am I right?
Yeah, because it was a warlock. Then I made another one just because might as well have all three.
I
have 1,719 hours of deleted characters.
That's craziness. Oh, well, how much was that Titan that you just deleted?
That Titan was 1,000 hours.
Damn. Wow. I can't
believe you did that.
I was Triple Hunter on Xbox. And I loved it. I loved being Triple Hunter. And that was basically up until February. But my buddy was Triple Warlock. And he's a little arrogant, you know, so it made sense.
Oh, yeah, I can believe that.
He's a little arrogant in real life and also arrogant in the way he picked his warlocks and stuff. So I had like a direct opposition. I was like, no way am I going to make a warlock until he quit Destiny. So he quit Destiny and I made a warlock. So, yeah.
All my friends quit Destiny. It's a sad day.
Yeah, I've got a whole new group of people that I play with beginning. Too. Totally different. Jonathan Iyer says, I think everyone is assuming that there will be a beta for Destiny 2. When do you guys think it'll happen? I can confirm, actually, that there is a beta for Destiny 2, and it is being released in September of 2014.
Oh.
Get it? Oh. Get it?
Oh. This guy thinks nailed he's it. Clever.
Got the jokes.
High five? Huh?
I remember people used to say that about Tekken King. Oh, is this the real Destiny 1? I know. I remember that, seeing that on Reddit.
Oh, I can't wait to see the memes in Destiny 2 of what we just roast the game about. I can't believe they did this in Destiny 2. Unbelievable.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure.
Nathan Tweedell says, seeing as Tefty pretty much nailed it with predicting this update, how smug is he feeling right now? Tefty, how smug are you feeling right now?
Not at all.
Tell us about how smug you are.
I don't want to be smug. Please, no.
How smug is the beard?
Maybe a little bit.
A little bit smug?
Just the beard, though. Not me personally.
Just the beard.
Stephen I says, what page is the new in the new book really relates to you? Collectors, raids, trials, crucible?
Hunter.
Page.
Hunter.
Hunter.
I'm in the crucible. I don't know. I don't think I'm going to be able to get a raid team together to do all those raids. I'm no pro raider, man. I'm kind of a...
Well, you're on PlayStation, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll hook you up.
Your Holly mod Ares can take care of you. He'll hook you up with all the right people.
Yeah, he's got it down.
He's got all the right people to get you through it.
Book complete.
Yes. As a matter of fact, just give him your account and he'll finish it by the end of the week.
Oh, sweet.
I was really excited to see that there is going to be a trials page because I think that's something that's been left out of the previous moments of triumph. It's definitely a big moment of triumph, right? It's going to the lighthouse. Like, that should be in there.
Yeah.
Agreed. But what speaks to me, Destiny, I've been all over the map with Destiny. You know, I've put hours and hours into raids, into strikes, into Crucible, into Trials of Osiris. To me, it's like it's the whole package, right? It's like there's no one part of Destiny that really speaks to me more than every other part. It's the whole package that really makes it so appealing.
I got something to point out because didn't they have a Disturb the Remains thing?
Yes.
That is fantastic because if you were there for September 2014, you definitely took part in the massacre to make that happen. So
if you're listening and you don't know what we're talking about, the Loot Cave was a thing and Google it. And the way Bungie patched it, the way to kind of honor that moment that the community had with each other shooting blindly into a cave and gathering all the loot, is they put a pile of bones with a little, audio piece, that snippet that you, when you walked up to it, you could press a button on your controller and it plays a faint audio. And does anybody have it? Like, what does it say?
Says something about
a million deaths are not enough for Rahul.
Yeah.
It's a Dune reference.
I'm seeing comments right now saying that not everybody got to go to the lighthouse. Well, I mean, that doesn't make it not a triumph, right?
Like, yeah.
It's as much as a triumph as completing a raid or, you know, finding every ghost or, you know, it's a triumph. And yeah. You don't have to get every triumph in the book to,
yeah,
to get, you know, complete t-shirt. The book. Yeah. So it being included, I think, is a very good thing.
Yeah, I think it's a good thing.
There was no way that it couldn't be included, I think. I mean,
it hasn't been for the last 2 years.
Well, I know.
This is the first time Trials has been included in any fashion in the Triumphs type thing.
As far as an end game activity that marks this Destiny 1, I don't think you could possibly, I don't see how that you couldn't honor it. Because during the content droughts, that is what Trials, I believe, is what carried Destiny during these content droughts.
Mm-hmm. I would agree.
Yeah,
I agree.
Also, if you look at what's the master rank or the top rank in Overwatch?
It's like 3,000. Oh.
No, what's it called? Is it master rank? Master level?
Grandmaster.
I mean, not everybody's going to be Grandmaster in Overwatch. It's a title that only some people can get, you know? So even though it's not in a record book, I mean, well, it's a title.
You mean everybody doesn't get a trophy, Tefty? Come on.
Well, for that particular thing, it's...
I know, but that's the point. It was that, like, there's a whole generation that grew up where everybody got a trophy for, you know, if you participated, everybody got the same trophy. And I see it with my son, and he plays sports. There used to be a kid that, you know, was the top on the team and second place on the team and third place on the team and most improved and stuff like that.
And it now didn't matter because the coach's son got everything.
Oh, Jesus.
Fuck.
I'm just saying that I am not opposed to a game as diverse as Destiny to have rewards that are not attainable by everybody. Because
what was the original question? Sorry, I had to step out.
I was going to move on to the next question because we've been talking about this for like 10 minutes.
Okay, that's fine.
James Pratt says, what is special to you about the Destiny community and what about it annoys you? I mean, what's special about the community to me is, especially on Twitch, the positivity and the friendliness and the inclusiveness. What annoys me is the people, especially on the PvP side, who just seem to focus on the negativity.
Yeah.
I don't find a place for it in my chat. Like, those people just get banned immediately.
The thing that I find that I'm most excited about the Destiny community is their willingness to participate in, to help each other and to collaborate on things like charity live streams and getting behind supporting each other.
Yeah.
That's what I think is most awesome.
The best thing is that, to me, about the community is how many members are willing to let, you know, this game extend beyond the game into other areas of life. You know, we've seen the charity thing. We've seen relationships form because that, you know, people are meeting new friends that they find in their cities. Yeah. Giggle all you want. And you know, that's what makes, you know, I seem to be always gravitating towards games that seem to lend themselves well to that. So you guys, you know, we rag on my time in WoW, but, you know, I've met many people from that video game in real life. And, you know, I've formed lasting friendships because of that game. And Destiny is very much the same way for that. As far as annoying things, oh shit, there's gonna be people that just annoy you in whatever game, in whatever ways that, I don't know. People focus on negative stuff, sure. That's gonna be with anything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, go for it.
Oh, no, go ahead, Jeff.
Yeah, I would say the supportive nature of the community, honestly, is like nothing else. It's incredible. Generosity, willing to help people out, give people a hand, all that stuff from the Twitch side, even on YouTube and all that. It's really incredible. On the negative side, I wish that the community wasn't so quick to judge when something gets released or announced and stuff like that. Like, there's an immediate cynicism that kicks in, and it's kind of like baked into the community right now because of what we've gone through with not getting any information from Bungie and how it's been treated. And I wish it just wasn't like that. It would be nice if that cynicism was like toned down to like 10% of what it is. And hopefully in Destiny 2, that is the case. But I kind of fear that it's going to continue going that route where it's just immediate snap judgments are going to be like the theme for a lot of voices out there.
Yeah, I agree with that. For me, the positives is after my fiance was deployed and I lost my job, me being able to connect on Destiny and actually like forge friendships, that was just a great thing. Like it really was like this awesome time, you know, even though like I was just like, oh, you know, I still had friends who were like, hey, let's get on, let's play. And like, you know, running Relic for the first time in Vault of Glass, you get a Fatebringer, you're like, sweet, you know, it's definitely stuff like that. And then, you know, just like as a content creator that, you know, rose up, you know, like it's great to see like the community that kind of like comes with you. And that's what I'm grateful for. What I'm annoyed is there's no trailer for Destiny 2. I need it.
So we're walking away from this podcast knowing that Blessius wants a trailer.
I needs it.
Right.
I needs the trailers.
Rich says, what impact will more elemental primaries have on the game, good or bad?
At this point, it doesn't matter.
More awesomeness.
At this point, you know, they didn't have them in Taken King and on with the reason citing those were the primaries that were, you know, most used in year one because they were the, you know, they were that elemental thing just added a little bit more, you know, PvE viability to them. And now that that's gone, you know, you're free to use kind of whatever you wanted to. And at this point in the game, when there's, you know, only what, 5 months left ish, 5-6 months in theory, you know, who cares? It doesn't really matter what gets used the most in PvE. Just let people have some fun using some elemental primaries.
I agree.
Yep.
Especially since it's not going to carry over to Destiny 2. Go nuts. Let us reforge it all too.
Yeah.
Let the last few months be utter chaos and abandon. Just put the light levels, just jack everything up.
Everything is mayhem. Everything is mayhem now.
Year one, like, sandbox, just go.
Unlimited glimmer and legendary marks.
Warlocks can have their supers for like an hour, you know?
Horizon Zero Subcult says, Destiny 1 is a game that's not... Oh, okay. Deej said, Destiny 1 is a game that's not going away, and presumably you buy Destiny 2, will you still play Destiny 1?
We kind of answered this last week. Again, my answer is like, it's a 3-year limit, or a 3-year bubble, where I will probably not go back to Destiny 1 until possibly 3 years later, where I'll have a nostalgia kick in and be like, I want to see what happened, or what, relive that. But during those 3 years, I will not have a desire to go back to Destiny 1, so long as Destiny 2 exists.
I did see a video recently, I think it was by Cruiser, where he picked up the Xbox 360 version, and that hasn't been updated since before Rise of Iron came out.
Yeah.
So the special weapon stuff is all the same there. Like, so if you're big into sniping, like, it's all the same as it used to be.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm. No breaker, no clip.
Michael J. Vasquez says, do you think they will release the PS-exclusive weapons and gear to Xbox One players with this new update?
God, that would be nice.
I don't think they're going to do it, though.
I don't think they will, though.
I really don't think so. I think they, when Rise of Iron came out, didn't they extend it by a year, basically, on their website?
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, I would have thought that would be up, though. But, yeah, it makes sense if they continue that. September of this year is when you probably get it.
Yeah.
I think the working theory is that the exclusives were supposed to be held from Taken King until Destiny 2, but they had to extend development of it for another year. So, yep, that got kind of caught and didn't get them. But hey, you know, if they, I mean, I imagine that when Destiny 2 comes out, Xbox and players will get them on Destiny 1. So then you can go back to Destiny 1 and use Jade Rabbit.
Yeah,
Call of Vance's duty.
That'll make them feel better.
That makes them.
I wish this Age of Triumph, I'm sure you guys said this, but I wish it released all the stuff to Xbox.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I don't know. I really wish. Maybe it will. Maybe that's part of the sandbox thing. Is like, oh, yeah, we're finally adding all this other stuff.
I was wondering.
That'd be
about
a cool thing for Bungie to do.
That would be really cool. But didn't they say that it was being extended one whole year?
Yeah. Did they say a whole year, up to a year?
On the website when Rise of Iron was coming out, like the text on the website changed from to be released, I think, in September 2017 or 2016 to September 2017.
Okay,
isn't that crazy?
Okay, it clearly got moved out.
I mean, it's because now it's absolutely 100% official that none of it's going to matter for Destiny 2. For those exclusives.
Yeah, it's brutal, man. Those exclusives were just like, they were just console exclusives is what they were, like completely. Yeah.
I still say the Hawk Moon is worse, though.
Because it was better in year one.
The Hawk Moon was fantastic in year one. It was
a beautiful
game. And got crushed in year two when the Xbox players got it. So they've never had that weapon in all.
I never had that as a PlayStation player, man. That's why I made the other two characters for that vault of glass chest. I never got it. I got it week one of Taken King. I'm like, it's broken.
It's rough. Yeah, that sucks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mike Disharoon says, looking past this update, are you all starting to mentally prepare yourselves for the D2 content creation grind this fall? This fall? That shit started this summer, man.
I know, right? I'm planning my move on the theory that it's like, okay, if they start releasing information around this time, I don't want to be moving across the country. Hell, I just missed just this one week. And I was like, oh, God, I didn't even get to put out a video on Wednesday. You know, I had to wait a whole 24 hours. I'm planning my move around
it. Patrick. Now's the time you want to get that rest.
Hey, man, I'll be living in Seattle. Coffee will be in abundance.
There you go.
All good.
Oh, there's some good coffee there, too.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm not talking Starbucks. I'm talking.
Oh, I'm aware. Obviously. I'm aware.
Yeah.
They don't have Starbucks in Tennessee.
Really?
I'm just joking.
I mean, really? That's like holy crap,
that, man. How about that?
I might move to Tennessee. Oh my God.
I should have played in on that. Dang it.
That's how backward it is there? I'm just kidding. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How about you, Tefty? You still do YouTube, but it's mostly you're bringing your streams over to YouTube. Are you kind of like getting mentally prepared for Destiny 2? Have you kind of?
I'm on the fence.
You're doing a lot more variety streaming than you used to.
I have been. Yeah, I'm really on the fence right now. There's a part of me that, like, I've actually been toying with the idea of potentially making a separate channel just for my Destiny related information slash content. But if I do that, then I really do have to commit towards making at least 3 videos a week for Destiny related content, which I kind of already do right now. I mean, I do a Destiny reset video and a Azure video and then like a Nightfall of memes, but those are pretty low impact, pretty easy to do type of content. You know, like reviews, as you guys know, they're like a day.
That's not happening.
Well, they're like a day, 2 day process pretty easily.
Yeah.
You know, to get everything put together to do it right. But I don't know. I'm on the fence really because streaming is my main gig. I love streaming. It's always going to be the thing that I want to make sure doesn't get cut in any kind of way. And then, but there are times where I'm thinking, man, with Destiny 2 coming out, there is a part of me that wants to be positioned to be able to make content if I want to.
I got a channel name for you for your Destiny thing.
Hit me with it.
What's that?
Teftany 2.
I think it's a high five.
High five. Almost got it.
Bad jokes.
This is great.
Jason says, will Bungie confirm what veteran rewards will be for Destiny 2? The new emblems are nice, but what's the point if no carryover?
I get it. You want stuff to carry over. Maybe there will be some things that recognize who you were in Destiny 1 in Destiny 2. We don't you know, maybe they'll hopefully, if there is, they'll tell us about that later to kind of incentivize us doing this.
They called them honors, right? They did specifically call out there will be stuff.
Yeah. So, you know, for now, do it. If you find doing the activities fun, if you want to complete a book, cool, do it. You know, play the game because it's fun. Don't play it because you think it's a task that needs to be done. That's what makes the game not fun.
It's not a job.
Yeah. Yep. Well, it is for some of us. But.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. We're not going to find out what those rewards are anytime soon.
Yeah.
Like, I would be surprised if we found out about them before Destiny 2 came out.
Yeah, exactly.
Rocco317 said, what raid are you most excited to play in Age of Triumph? What do you hope to see in VOG and CE challenge modes? We already talked about challenge modes, but which one are you most excited to play?
All the glass.
Yep, VOG.
VOG again, truthfully. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I was going to go with something different just to be different.
Go with King's Fall. Do it.
King's Fall.
King's Fall. I can't.
Do it.
You're lying.
Go with King's Fall.
I screw the other raids. I mean, honestly, if King's Fall was the only raid we ever got in Destiny, I would be completely satisfied. I'm
King's
really
Fall was
excited.
A great raid. It just didn't hold up to repeated play. Wow. Right? Like, wasn't that the problem?
I don't know how Say No to Rage did that, man.
Everybody. I don't either, man.
I don't know how he did that.
I know that he's really reticent to do it again, though. I actually am more excited for Crota's End just because it seemed like from the live stream that that's where a lot of changes were going to take place. I still say that was a fun raid. It just had so many issues to it that messed up your experience. Mm-hmm. That could be a lot of fun. And it's a shorter raid, and that makes it pretty exciting. You know, you get in and out of there with a good team in a half hour and have a good time. You know, so I'm actually looking forward to Crota's End the most. Long-term play, it'll probably be VOG, but I'm looking forward to seeing the changes to Crota's End the most.
Yeah.
In and out of there in a half hour, and you'll have a good time.
Nailed it.
Sounds like the slogan for...
Sounds like my Friday nights.
they are also... Okay, so... Those three raids had to be supported on the previous consoles. And now they could do these changes and not have to worry about previous console stuff. So I wonder if that's going to make any kind of effect for the net code and potentially prevent any kind of like a teleporting ogres and crap like that. I don't know. If that's going to make a difference.
I'm going to go with net code for the first time. I already finished my beer, Taffy.
You're welcome.
Yeah, I got a new one just in case you would.
Fuck.
I don't know. It might make a difference. It's possible, might not. I don't know.
So, do you think we're gonna get? Do you think we're gonna in the live streams? Do you think we're gonna hear about Prison of Elders?
I think Skolas is probably coming back. They did have a little icon for that. Why wouldn't they bring Skolas back?
Do they have an icon for it?
Yeah, I thought they had an icon on there.
I thought they had one too, but I couldn't.
Yeah.
Yeah. On the weekly,
it looks like the POE icon on the
weekly things. Why wouldn't Skolas come back?
Skolas is a badass fight when you are light level, under light level.
It's a pain in the ass of a fight.
Did you ever do a carry?
Room does arc burn?
Yeah.
Oh my god!
I did a carry, and it's usually someone died
with no bike.
Yeah, that's really hard to do.
I hated
you did it. You did it with the no micer.
Yeah, he couldn't tell us when he was the taint was running out. So he had to do a dance, and we had to watch the corner of the screen for him to dance so that we'd know when we had to pick up the taint.
Oh, I hate it.
You don't want to drop that taint, man. It's bad news.
Mm-hmm. No, you drop that taint on, things go bad.
Yeah, you got to time that taint perfectly.
Being a person that LFG'd that a lot, it was a pain in the butt when someone would leave, and like you have to go, and like you have to kill yourselves for someone to join in. It was such a pain in the butt.
Ugh.
And LFG is toxic, man. What? You don't have a black hammer?
Yeah.
Like, yeah, it was bad.
Mr. Goodbite says, some of us have bad RNG. Think they might unlock all exotics for purchase in the kiosks eventually?
I think one of the requirements is collecting exotics, so I don't think they'll just, like, completely unlock it.
Yeah.
Wow.
No.
I mean, I feel bad for you, but I don't.
Pope.
What?
You can't say that.
I know,
you
man.
You can't say that.
I want to get negative comments in the. All right, no. You know what? I hear what you're saying. It's struggling because, like, you know, you want that gun that everybody else has, and I can understand where you want it, but they're going to increase the drop rates to account for that. I think everybody will get the exotics by the time if you play a regular amount.
Yeah.
I mean, I know I got this reputation for getting having crazy RNG, but the fact of the matter is I was no-lifing it. I was playing all the time. So I was getting stuff because I was playing all the time. And now that I don't play all the time, I don't have the RNG that you guys have because I just don't play as often. Mm-hmm. So I think by increasing the drop rate, I think it's going to be better for casual players.
Also, you're going to have 4 raids times 3 characters per week that are going to have exotic potential for dropping. And then if you combine
I don't know if I'm going to be doing that. 4 raids a week.
No.
I don't know.
Well, no.
I don't have time for Destiny anymore.
Right, but if you need the exotic drops, I'm just saying it's there. The potential's there. Sorry. And 3 coin popping. Like, oh, that was something they mentioned. They were going to actually make some of those bosses utilize 3 coins now.
Oh, that's nice.
Good. Yeah.
Yep.
That's good. You know, we're going to be doing the raids together, right? On Tuesday nights?
Yeah.
When they first launch, we'll be doing them live streams.
Let's go ahead and announce the giveaway, too, because that's something people want to be more than ready to take advantage of. Mm-hmm. So we have 5 members on the podcast. You need 6 mm-hmm. for a raid team.
Mm-hmm.
I
think Blessious might have just taken that spot.
Screw him. He's out. We're going to do a giveaway for a blue mic and a spot on our raid team for when we go through some of the stuff. Mm-hmm.
What if you win and you play on Xbox?
PS4 only.
We
really should have thought of that one. Damn. Now I feel kind of bad for announcing this one. Well, no matter what, you will get
you're on Xbox,
the Blue Yeti.
Right?
Yeah. Kind of.
Like, yeah. Or.
Yeah, I technically have a character on the Xbox.
Am I the only one with like current light level?
You are.
Yeah, you are.
You guys.
You'll get a raid with Tefty.
I just couldn't keep up.
You'll get a raid with Tefty and a blue microphone.
If you're on Xbox.
Yeah. Yeah, there you go.
And then we'll still roll for the PS4.
For the PS4 run. So that giveaway will be, let's see, the patch is coming out the 28th of this month. So the giveaway will be on the 23rd of March. So 2 weeks from now, not next episode, but the one after that, that is when the giveaway will take place. For a position on the raid team, and
raffle during the show.
Yeah, we'll raffle it off during the podcast.
Is that going to be the one podcast, with maybe? On the 23rd?
Yes,
that's going to be the one.
You got to be here live to win.
Oh, that's gonna be fun,
Patrick. You got to be here live to win, and we'll do it right after the podcast. Yes,
you have to be here live. We will do the giveaway right at the end of the podcast.
Hey, Briar, I bet you money Blue wins randomly.
A microphone and a raid?
Uh-huh. Yeah, I bet you Tefty figures out some way of, you know...
Finagling?
Fixing it. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if it turns out that you guys, that whoever wins can't get in, like when we're doing the raid, we'll find a way to for all of us to get together and still raid. Like, whoever wins the raffle will win a raid with us, depending on, like, your scheduling. So
who are we fooling? All they want is that damn microphone.
The microphone.
The wild mic and just wild mic.
Can you do you know what? We really need to have Blessius do the ad copy afterwards as Christopher Walken. Send him the ad copy and we'll record it later so we can put it in instead of that monstrosity that you did.
Anthony Messina says, do you have a catchphrase in trials when you get a wrecking ball? Mine is Ray Lewis, catch a whiff of these. Mine is because I'm just shocked.
I literally start screaming at the top of my lungs. I start singing Miley Cyrus.
Me too.
She gave me like a
god.
It's tough for me to get away from that one, honestly.
I do it. What do you do, Patrick?
I get them so often that it's just not even a thing for me. I'm usually just like, oh, okay. I don't even notice it.
Next question. Bessie says, with the lactose intolerant update to raids, with cheese, which cheese will you guys miss the most?
None of them. I didn't really use the cheese.
I am more allergic to cheese in video games than Tefty is to bread gluten in real life.
So there's two that I still actively do. One is getting a hunt. I don't know if this one's actually a cheese, but getting a hunter with Don't Touch Me on and just booking it through the beginning of the Crota raid. Uh-huh. I'll do that still. Like, if I have a raid team and we have a bit of trouble, I'll just be like, okay, hold on. I'm just going to put a Blade Dancer on and book it through the beginning of this. And the second one is swinging that sword across the bridge. I'll still do that one, too, if we're having trouble there.
Yeah.
I'm not going to lie. I'll cheese a raid.
I've never done it without doing the sword, to be honest. Just someone just going,
what?
No, I've never done it legit.
Oh God, I'm gonna raid. I'm gonna invite you to a raid. I have never actually. I don't even know the cheeses for these raids. That's how I
you never even did the Sunsinger cheese on Atheon.
Never. I swear.
You never saw the Icebreaker cheese for the.
I am dead.
Did you never
serious.
LFG in year one? What the fuck?
Like, yeah, no, seriously. I have never ever LFG'd. My hand to God. Man. I refuse to cheese. Everybody that's ever played with me, I will leave a raid if they start cheesing. I'll go, bye. See you guys. And it's not that I'm better than anybody. It's just that I just don't enjoy it. I like to play the engagements as they're designed.
I agree with you on that one. Yo, do you guys remember the Infinite Quiver? Like the.
Oh, yeah, I remember that. That was fun.
People just go through the jumping puzzle.
Yeah.
After 5 hours of Crota glitching out, I'm not going to lie, I pulled out a LAN cable or two in my day.
Really?
I never got to do that one. I never tried that.
Never did that. Oh, my God.
Dude, my LAN cable all the way
upstairs. That fight was so fucking glitched for so long.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? I did that. I was doing, I got to tell you guys a story, because I was doing that raid as a bungee ride-along. And so I dropped into the Dark Below with Urk and the designers Indige of the raid, right? And we go down into the boss fight, and you know the sword, we were doing it I think on normal, and I know they were getting a bunch of crap for it for us doing it on normal, but we did it on normal and the sword disappeared.
Oh, I remember seeing that happen. That was hilarious.
That sucked. I remember that. And stream. Nobody in your raid team would believe you if you were the guy running to get it. Like, what'd you do? The sword wasn't there. Bullshit, it wasn't there.
But this was on the live stream. This was on, like, you know, thousands of people were watching. And, oh, man, that was funny. That made me laugh so hard. But, yeah, that raid, I know, was messed up.
It was messed up. It was bad. Andy Martinez says, how does the DCP crew feel about the light level not going up with Age of Triumph?
I'm completely fine with it, because they even said, no, we're not going to raise the light level, because that would be just further pulling a chain for no real reason. Boom.
Yeah.
Do you agree with that statement, though?
Yes.
Okay. I really wanted to see it at 420, I'm not going to lie.
420. I mean, yeah. Awesome. I would have liked to see it at 422 just for the joke of it being 420.
It would have been entertaining.
20
light levels. Like, if the raids were like 410 light, we're at 400 now, it would have given us just enough of a grind so that, like, halfway through your first raid, you'd probably be like 410 anyway.
See, Here's how I think of it. For us, it would be no problem having to attain a new light level for all of our characters and everything. But there's going to be a lot of people out there who are going to think, oh, now I have to do all this record book stuff and try to achieve max light level before Destiny 2 comes out. It's like you said, it's pulling the chain more. You know, it's like, is it a warranted need? Like, what are you doing with that extra light level? It makes sense that they're not doing it, because it's more of a celebration towards the end of Destiny, as opposed to, hey, here's some new content. Oh, wait, it's not new content.
You know what it would have done?
It's old raids, you know?
It would have made it really exciting to get that high light level gear out of the raid. That's what it would have done.
It would have.
Like, because you would have gone in there at 400 light, And then as you came out of that raid, you'd be higher and higher light. It would have felt really exciting.
Not for me. I feel like it's another burden. I'd have to, it's like, oh great, now I have to upgrade all my gear to 420 now. Great. Cool. That joke would have to. I mean, you don't have to, but Trials of Osiris, the game mode I played a lot, I need to get up to 420 light to remain competitive.
Yeah, I can see how that could be a pain.
I would have liked to see it, I'll be honest with you. I'm not that upset about not seeing it, but I would have liked to see it. Chris says, what is the likelihood that we will get to hear Helium Briar again? Maybe the whole podcast sometime?
No, I'm not going to do the whole podcast. That was just because I said I would do it, so I had to do it.
I'm not going to lie, that shit was funny. I didn't know about it until the next day everybody started tweeting me about it. I'm like,
yeah.
I thought he'd be too tired to actually go through with it.
No, I passed out after last week's podcast. Like, you guys saw me leave. That wasn't a rage quit. That was just me. I was fucking exhausted, like, before the podcast even started, and wasn't feeling well. Got up, left for like 20 minutes, came back, and then I got you guys' files. I just passed out. I didn't even edit it until the morning. And its podcast still only went up like 6 hours later than it normally would have. So all works out.
Mr. Tug says there are 4 new challenge modes: Templar, Atheon, and Crota. Is the Death Singer really getting her own? I really don't think it's going to be the Death Singer.
I don't think it's Death Singer. No,
I think it's
Bridges. I wouldn't be surprised if actually that whole portion of that raid isn't one of the things that they adjusted.
Like, it's like removing the amount of knights. That
yeah, it's ridiculous and it's boring.
What if I think I heard something about this, but correct me if I'm wrong. Did they suggest that they were going to do a raid where the challenge was to do all of the challenge modes?
That's the weekly, like the weekly raid thing. All challenge modes will be active in it.
Yeah.
So you could only choose...
One raid will be the weekly raid, and in that raid, all challenge modes will be active.
So you could choose to do from beginning to end all the engagements challenge mode.
Yes.
Each weekly.
Okay.
Yeah.
I misunderstood. Yep. I was looking for a Nightfall-esque raid with all challenge modes where you would have burns and stuff like that.
No.
Yeah, I don't think they're doing that.
All
right. Jacob Haas says, vehicles and turrets have been underused in Destiny 1. How would you implement them in Destiny 2's PvE and PvP?
Be able to use your ship like a Banshee.
That'd be cool. I used to love running the Banshee. That was fun.
Yeah, the problem with the vehicles is they never found that perfect spot for them.
They never made them fun.
Well, I mean, they were really good in the alpha and the beta, and then people just hated it. So the damage on them got reduced down so much that even in PvE, there was no real reason to use them over just your primary weapon. And a lot of times you were way more vulnerable in them. So, and even like combined arms, when vehicles are popping up, it just takes like one sniper round and you're dead. Or, they use a super to destroy the vehicle. The vehicles needed some pretty heavy reworks, I think, if they want to see them used in either PvE or PvP.
Yeah, I would agree with that. They feel weak. They don't feel fun to drive. Like, none of them do.
It's like
except for the Sparrow.
I would like to see Sparrows in Destiny 2 that do more than what our Sparrows do now, that have features like
guns,
that have certain abilities, lasers. Guns.
They got like curb
laser beams,
and
grenade launchers.
I don't know.
Hydraulics. So like,
I would like to see a dual seater, like a dually, some sort of Sparrow where you like can sit your two. You just jump on your, and then you're going through patrol, and then somebody, and then somebody can jump on your Sparrow, and you can pick up a couple guardians, and drive them around
like a mongoose.
But with two, a mongoose, but like you can put your fire team of three on there, and you could have like that triple, hey guys, just jump on, and then you can go together. I don't know. I like it.
Yeah, I like it.
Who wants to be the guy riding though?
like a banana boat.
I do.
You know,
I do.
Where that you ride the three people, like the.
No, it's
see, if you're riding, you get to shoot weapons. Pretty well,
bless
no, what'd you say? Just put me in there. I'm gonna go get some coffee. I'll be right back.
No, exactly.
That's what it's used that for. Is convenient, though.
Yeah, no, it, that's like what it's used for. And wow, like there's two seater mounts there, and it's like, oh, I need to go run do this real quick. Drive us to the next location, and you know, you're just driving them over. Cool.
In Halo, it was all about you were the gunner, right? You get on the back of the mongoose, and you were the gunner. It was not nearly as fun as being on the back of a warthog, though, because you had a big ass gun.
Especially if you got the Gauss cannon.
Yes.
Oh, man. Awesome. Gauss cannon.
I miss Those Halo sometimes.
Days, sometimes.
Wheels says, why do people have a hard time with the warlock jump? You just have to double tap the button quickly.
Look, I'm a titan, man.
We have been playing games with double jumps in them for, I don't know, 30 years, 40 years.
Like, at least.
The legacy of the double jump is not short. No. And throughout its history, you hit the jump button once and you jump high. You hit the second time and you jump higher.
Right.
The warlock does not act in this way.
No. It's got a fluffy
the
warlock, boost.
You hit the jump button once you jump high, you hit it again, and you float down to your fucking doom.
Yeah, bad. Yes.
And you miss the jump.
Yep. Nobody likes that.
You're Floaty McFloaterson.
Like, it's usable if you use it all the time, but if you're switching between like hunters and warlocks or titans and warlocks, you just both go down, have good like, jumps. What? Yeah. It's annoying. It's fine if you play a warlock a lot, but if you don't,
and it would be okay also if the initial boost was aggressive, like really high. It'd be like, okay, you have this like strange jetpack floofy thing because you have to double tap right away. But no, it's just like, okay, let's rise on up.
Well, like a butterfly, I guess.
It's the worst way to die in the game.
It's awful.
Oh, the slow motion death
takes fucking forever.
And you, just, you gotta wait you gotta until you hit the kill volume. You're like,
versus switching characters, and you're going into, you know, King's Fall and doing the puzzle, and you're like, no, and you just fall, and it's forever to die.
Oh man,
it's rough.
Or how about when you end a one life that way in a pit? Oh wait,
yeah. Can we get a clip of that? Link in chat, please. I need a little cheerful thing before I go to bed tonight. Charles Champion says, how are y'all enjoying Zelda and also the new update for Destiny? I can't wait. I will get the shirt this time. We talked about Zelda a little bit.
Yeah,
Zelda's love, Zelda's life.
Zelda's fantastic.
We kind of already talked about everything in this question. I'm just going to move on. City Smackman said, how timely do you think Bungie will handle balancing patches and updates come Destiny 2?
They need a PTR.
Be nice. I don't know if it's going to happen because they're so secretive about their stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, we don't know. But they've apparently, here's what I'm assuming, is that they've got their content release down and it's going to be consistent and reliable. And with that is also built in. I'm putting it on record that it's going to be consistent and reliable, Tefty.
You think?
Uh-huh.
Some nice vague terms.
It's going to be consistent and reliable, and before every and in between the you know the content releases, there are going to be patches, and
that'd be great.
You know, that's what we're going to get.
I love it. I hope you're right.
So basically, Destiny 2 will be like a Volvo.
Didn't Volvo have
or a Honda or a Honda?
Yeah, Honda or Volvo. Yep, mm-hmm. Reliable.
Yep, super reliable. You'll be able to set your clock to the content release.
I feel like a lot of the inconsistencies that we've seen in Destiny 1's life cycle have been due to just them dedicating so many people to Destiny 2. And I know they have a live team to still make patches, but still it's such a small percentage of people that are working on the game right now.
I hope that Destiny 2 throughout its lifespan looks more like Destiny 1 in year 1, where we're seeing, you know, pretty consistent updates. And we're getting DLCs, like big DLC, story-driven DLCs throughout the year. Bungie's got something to prove to me in regards to that, because I still feel like that is a promise that they never kept. And I understand that the game got delayed, but you know,
we're starting over. You know. We're starting over, Briar. this is a new girl. That was our old, Destiny 1 was our old boo.
This is like the last girl's sister.
Yeah. she's you know, you're going to be able to go to the family reunions and and still see her, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. But it's going to be a totally different girl.
Guys.
Yeah, we'll see.
I don't know about that analogy. I think the better analogy is an upgraded car.
What's wrong with that?
Like you've like 3 years later getting the car that's fixed everything, you know, like they
upgrade into the Volvo S5.
Yeah.
When you had the S3
and they redesigned everything three years later and they put in all these features that you've been complaining about, you know?
Yeah. I hope so, man. Like I hope that they've created Destiny 2 in a way that content is going to be much more regular.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I've seen no indication that's going to happen, except for what Activision has said.
Yeah. But again, like, don't measure that until we're 6 months into Destiny 2.
For sure.
That's when to measure it. And if it is historically looking the same, then that sucks.
It's going to be disappointing if we have, like, 6 month long droughts in between content.
That will suck.
Yeah, it's going to suck.
Nick Owen says, sushi dipped in tempura or raw to the core?
Tempura.
Raw. I like it raw and wiggly.
Fucking raw.
Raw because...
Is it even called sushi if it's dipped in tempura?
It's called tempura.
Yeah, that's what I thought. I thought it was just called tempura.
There's sashimi. And there's sashimi is what I really like. I don't know.
Yeah, the slices.
That's just the...
Slices of raw fish. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. We live in the Bay Area. So the fish here is extremely fresh.
Mm. And oh my God. I get to move to Seattle and have actual fresh seafood instead of being in the middle of a landlocked state. Oh, I just.
Fresh salmon and is just.
That's my favorite.
Oh my God.
Oh, I know.
Yeah. Fresh salmon is my favorite. When the tuna is perfect. Oh my God. Can't get enough. I can't have tempura because it's typically. Wheat flour, all that.
The burrito is delicious. Like, I'll get the shrimp that looks like it's been, like, stretched out and, like, fried. It's delicious. It's a different kind of fry than what you're used to.
Light and flaky.
But I really like raw sushi. Like, it's just it's a good thing.
I'm a sissy. I need it fried.
Next time you're in San Francisco, Blessious, I'll take you to a couple sushi places that will blow your mind.
Yeah, you just got to have some good fish, and then you'll be like, oh, this is why people eat sushi. Because all it takes is one bad piece of sushi to, like, forever make it not...
Ruin it?
Yeah, or, like, a really...
It takes one encounter with tuna, airport, you know? Sushi.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Yikes.
The reality is the best sushi, honestly, you could just go to the... You go to a sushi-grade fish market, buy a couple pieces of fish, and bring them home and make them at home. That's really the best sushi.
I don't know what I'm doing, though.
It's not that hard.
Someday I'll have to tell you why that's not a good idea when I tell you the Pop-Tart story.
Oh, Cameron, I want to hear the Pop-Tart story.
Oh. One day.
Pop-Tart? Jesus. Oh.
Cameron Robinson says,
that was
which
mine.
Type
Sorry.
Which type of perk system would you want on revamped raid weapons? Randomized or set of collaborative perks?
Set of perks.
I like sets.
Sets.
Set of perks. We only got like 5 months to play this shit. Let me get the weapon, be done with it. I don't want to have to. I don't want to have to grind for a properly rolled weapon, in the last 5 months of the game.
What if we had sets? What if we had randomized sets? So every set was
like King's Fall.
No, they had randomly. The individual
Trials of Osiris weapons are randomly assigned sets.
What?
Well, there's like three. There's different sets of them. There's different roles of like the whole gun. No. It doesn't come in one.
No.
Yes.
I think so.
No.
Yes.
Oh, are you talking about like the past ones? Yes, but current ones, no.
No, like the doctrine came.
Okay,
in
the past year two. Past yeah. Ones. Not now.
Yeah. Though. Well, that's what I'm talking about. The ones that matter.
You have to be specific. There's 3 years of trials weapons, Pope.
The new ones suck. Anyway, there's some that are okay. New ones never are good. Mind. They're all right, but I like the old
Winged Word, baby.
Yeah. Great sniper rifle.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I don't like it, but that's all right.
I like it. I think it's cool. Andrew Nichols said, would you like to see the rest of year one and two vendor and faction weapons from rank up packages that aren't there now? There was no commas in there at all.
Can you read it one more time, Briar? Sorry.
Yeah. Would you like to see the rest of year one and two vendor and faction weapons from rank up packages that aren't there now?
Just everything in there.
Yeah. All the year one and two weapons back.
I wouldn't mind it. I think it'd be great.
It'd be cool.
Get everything.
There's so many shit weapons, though. Like, there's a couple of really good ones, but
why you got to be so judgy? That's okay.
I'm just saying, like,
new monarchy weapons.
Do you really want to get a devil you don't? Do you really want to get one of those in your rank up package?
Yeah, that gun was actually kind of fun to use.
Five round fastest rate of fire hand cannon.
Yeah, it was fun to use.
I mean, you know.
Are you really going to be happy to see that one, Briar?
Everybody's.
I'm not going to bring it into trials, but it was fun to use.
It's going to be a good laugh when you get the devil you don't.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because the devil you know is better than the devil you don't. Yeah, I'm so thankful that Bungie did that joke.
I used it quite a bit because I thought it was fun. Andrew Nichols, never mind. The Mohegan 9 says, do you snoop through your friends' medicine cabinets when you go visit them?
I saw that one. I saw that.
is that a reference to something, or is it genuine?
This one was actually asked by Miss 5000 Watts.
Oh.
To Patrick.
My God, Patrick. What'd you look for?
What? No, I didn't even get into her house.
Oh.
All right. Do you guys do that? Do you guys look through people's medicine cabinet?
No.
What? If you did, would you admit it?
What type of invasion of privacy? No.
Okay, the only time I've ever done that is when a friend of mine in college was a total douchebag. And I went over to his house and I took his toothbrush and I scrubbed the toilet with it, took a picture of it, put it back, and then a week later sent him the photo.
You are a fucking bad man.
Well, he was an asshole. So, you know, I have done that, but it's been very rare.
Got to knock him down.
Shit. Cameron Robinson says, do you think Kings and Wrath primaries will have elements too, so the raids are somewhat equal?
No. I don't think they're changing those.
I'm going to agree with Tefty here.
Yeah,
I don't think I'm going to move on to the next question. Them,
that's my only thing.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm with you on that.
Donald Neal says, will we have to do VOG again to get a 400 Vex or go to the exotic kiosk?
I'm going to say yes.
Yes. Yep.
You couldn't buy it. You couldn't buy the icebreaker from the exotic kiosk. Mm-hmm. So
it's true. You haven't been able to buy any of them that have been like updated in Rise of Iron. You had to do a quest for Thorn, Gallarhorn, icebreaker. Yeah, everything that got brought up had some sort of quest attached to it. You had to re-earn it. I think I'm like 99% positive on that.
Eric Peria says, are any of you guys Star Trek fans, and how awesome would it be to have a good Star Trek game?
Star Wars boy. Star Wars. My dogs are Han and Leia, man. I can't betray them.
That's pretty good. I like that. That's funny. I like Star Trek. Like,
I like Star Trek as well.
Yeah, I like Star Wars and I like Star Trek. I like
both.
I would
want it to be, I guess a good question, a variation of that is I'd want it to be in the Jean-Luc Picard era.
Yeah.
See, what made Star Trek so interesting is more all like the social commentaries that it did. Yes. You know, it's not a space gun laser, you know, action series. It never really has been until you get into the more modern reiterations of it. So I feel like Star Wars is a better cinematic universe due to, you know, the action oriented nature of it. But, Star Trek, I feel like Star Trek can be a much better role playing game. Maybe
there's actually a game coming out right now.
Is it?
I think it's expected out in the next couple of months. It's a VR game called Bridge Commander.
Oh yeah.
Where everybody puts on a VR headset and plays a member of the bridge crew.
Mm-hmm.
Like one person's a captain, one person's the ensign, one person's the science officer, and you got to like get through encounters as a team. And I can't wait for this game. I'm really looking forward to it.
How many headsets is that?
Well, you don't have, you're not all in the same, it's online.
Oh, I was going to say, that's an expensive little room right there.
I was like thinking the same thing.
You bump into each other.
Jesus.
How many headsets? Six headsets?
It's like seeing the old screenshots of the iPads. Like, look, you could play Scrabble. And each person had an iPad. And then there's an iPad in the center for the Scrabble board. And I was like, who would do that?
I now want to make a video of like six people in the same room trying to play VR.
They're all just clinking into each other.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just also, can't do it, Captain. I don't have do the power.
I feel like you're going to have to LFG that. How many people do you know have those headsets?
No one I know in real life.
Imagine trolling some three friends group, actually. You know, like, I'm hailing them, Captain, but they're not responding.
A lot of these VR games, too, as opposed to Destiny, are compatible between the different headsets. So if you have an HTC Vive, you can play with people who have Oculus. If you have an Oculus, you can play with people who have PSVR.
Really?
Yeah. How do you realize that? Because the player base is so small on each platform, they're much more open to sharing gameplay between
they have to. They have to, or else the format wouldn't go anywhere at the start.
Yeah.
Some of them, podcast in VR? Werewolves Within, I know, does it.
Oh, dude, I want to play that game. That game looks awesome.
I'll play it with you.
That's just, you know, just go for it. You know, I'm ready.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that doesn't look awkward at all.
That doesn't? Sweet.
No.
You get used to it real quick when you get like completely immersed in a video game. I'm playing a game doesn't called either. Onward right now, Pope Bear, that plays like Counter-Strike or Search and Destroy from Call of Duty.
Oh, God.
But you are in the game and you're holding a gun running around. It is fucking amazing.
All right.
Nice.
All right. I got to try it.
It is. You have to try it. You know, you can go to like a Microsoft store at the mall and they have them.
Yeah. I don't...
Yeah. As we established last week, there's no one at the Microsoft store. So you want to perfect line.
No line.
I can play there for hours.
I walked by one of
those.
You're
going to have to get out, sir.
Yeah.
I'm almost at the boss fight. Give me.
I walked by one of those this last weekend.
You don't have to buy it. Just walk into the store. There's no one there to like take your spot.
There was a kiosk. It was like, there wasn't a store. It was like planted in the middle of the walkway. Okay.
Yeah.
Like unavoidable.
Really? So they didn't have the VR setup?
You know, that can't be full of bacteria at all. I mean, that's got to be totally sanitary.
Exactly.
They wipe it with a little alcohol wipe.
Okay.
How much alcohol? Better douse that baby.
Yeah. The Oculus is down to $600 now, too.
If you try it and don't get pink eye, you should buy a lottery ticket.
$600.
My immune system's strong. I could do it.
That's almost a 1080 Ti.
What's that, $600?
Yeah.
Yeah. Except instead of just making your games look better in 2D, they immerse you into a world of three-dimensional gaming.
True.
They change the experience completely.
With a limited lineup. Excellent.
It is very limited lineup in software. Mike Hess says, are there any weapons from Crota's End that you missed and can't wait to get again at current light level?
Black
Oversoul Edict?
Necrochasm?
Necrochasm? Yeah, that's a badass gun.
Necrochasm performs really well too in PvP right now, so I'd love to see it
as well.
Yeah, I'd love to see it at a higher light level.
I never got a Necrochasm.
It was a bitch to get.
Yeah.
All the question was, was there anything you didn't get, right?
What weapon do you want to get?
I didn't miss anything, but I wouldn't mind seeing the Oversoul Edict come back.
Yeah, Necrochasm for me. It's a fun one.
Word of Crota was more fun than I think people give it credit for. Mr. Goodbite says, Deej asked in stream if we would simply infuse year one raid weapons up to 400, and the designer changed the subject. Think we will? Yes,
I saw that.
I doubt it. I doubt it. Maybe that's a sandbox question and not a raid designer question. I don't know.
Yeah. I hope so. Because I've still got them, and I could rub it in all those motherfuckers' faces who've been telling me to delete that shit for the last 2 years.
Now I really want them
to delete it on myself.
Just yes. So you're wrong.
I don't want Bozy, that.
Bozy, I'm coming for you on Twitter.
Thunder is really starting to roll in, so could we kind of wrap this up so my power
doesn't... All right, what do you think? Three more?
Yeah, sure.
All right, Chris Fouch says, what do you think of having proximity-activated voice chat in social spaces?
I'm down.
As long as I can turn it off, it sounds great.
Yeah.
If
Bungie was really against that when they released Destiny, weren't they? Like, they were trying to make a point about that.
I don't want my son playing in the tower and have some pedophile jackass come up to him and start.
As long as you can turn it off, I think it's a great idea.
I want it to like be on at by default, but you can turn it off and you'll never be able to hear anyone.
I'd rather
like,
have it be off by default and then turn it on if you want to join in.
If they do that, nobody will ever use it.
Good.
Except for the pedophiles.
Evan Meyer says, with Vex Mythic Class coming back, do you think it will still stay as a random RNG drop or will it be a quest?
I hope it's RNG.
I hope it's RNG too, personally.
I want to run that, run it for like weeks. Give me something to run that for.
All right, last question. Joe Sick and Foley, I'm glad we got this one. Hypothetical, let's say Destiny 2 releases tomorrow. What's the last thing you guys do in Destiny 1 as a final send-off?
Take out the disc.
Delete all my characters.
Delete all three characters, yep.
Peace.
You're going to really do that, Pope?
No. I've already done it. I mean, every one of them has been a new character in the last, like, 3 months.
Well, think about it, though. Like, tomorrow, Destiny 2 is out. What are you doing today in Destiny?
Something nostalgic. I'd probably get a bunch of people together and run, you know, Vault of Glass or do something nostalgic together that reminds me of the game.
I'm probably going to, like, be outside as much as possible because I'm going to play Destiny 2 for, like, an insane amount of hours.
Yeah. I wish I could give you a high five.
Sleep a little bit extra, you know?
Rest for the content grind.
Yeah, if I ever were to consider a 24-hour stream, it would probably be on the release of Destiny 2.
Yeah.
That's crazy. That's a good answer.
I can't think of anything that I'd want to do. Like, I'll just be looking forward to Destiny 2.
I'll be watching the trailer.
Yeah. And like
over and over
again. Like quarter speed, then half speed, then like normal speed, then like double Blessious speed.
Blessious will have the world record for the most views of the Destiny 2 trailer.
Put that in your moments of triumph, motherfuckers. That's great.
My moment of triumph, sure, will just be like a still picture of the YouTube video of the trailer. That's all I need.
That's all I need, baby. I don't even need the game. I just need the trailer. I
just need the trailer.
Should we wrap this one up, guys?
Yep. Yeah. I gotta go. Thunder's rolling in.
And the thunder rolls. Sorry.
Oh, bless you. It's you and I, man. We are on point tonight.
I know.
All right. Thank you, everyone, for tuning in to the 23rd episode of Destiny Community Podcast. If you want to find more of me, I am at Holtzmann_YT on Twitter, and you can find all my YouTube and Twitch links on there.
I'm Briar Rabbit. You can find me on YouTube. At the Briar Rabbit, I was able to switch my YouTube URL to c/Briar Rabbit. So the channel thing is gone forever.
Nice.
Congratulations.
Hey, congratulations.
I was happy about it. you can find me on Twitter at the Briar Rabbit. That's going to just have to stay there, I guess. Or streaming on Twitch as Briar Rabbit.
You can find me at Teft on Twitter.com. /Teft. That's where you talk to me. Catch the streams I do on twitch.tv/TeftyTeft and then stream archives on my YouTube channel, TeftyTeft.
Just don't ever direct message him because he'll never read your direct messages on Twitter ever.
Spoiler alert. Okay. I only don't read Pope's messages.
Go for it, Blessus.
My name is Blessius. I appreciate you guys having me. You can find me on youtube.com/Blessius, twitch.tv/Blessius, and I'm on Twitter at Blessius Plays because Blessius was taken.
Sons of bitches.
Who does that? Well, if you guys haven't checked out Blessius's streams and videos, you should. He's a funny guy and
best thumbnails on YouTube.
Hell yeah,
best thumbnails on YouTube. But definitely check him out. Thank you very much for coming on. This has been Pope Bear. You can find me on Twitter at Pope Bear. You can definitely find me, you know, poking around through these guys' channels, giving them a hard time.
All right, thank you all for tuning in, and we will see you next week. Bye-bye.
Bye, guys.
Adios.
All right.